Tonight, the Spring Roll Cart in Adventureland is reopened for spring break, and with it comes the busy season at the Casey's Corner restrooms. A brand new Her Universe collection is now available at Walt Disney World, and it's inspired by the transportation of the Disney parks. The collection was, of course, delayed several times before arrival and has a bit of a mildew smell to it. The Nine Dragons restaurant is still yet to reopen at Epcot, but inside is now being used as additional seating for the Lotus Blossom Cafe. For the time being, Figment will continue to perform the duties of all 10 of Epcot's dragons. You've read WDW News Tonight. Now it's time for WDW News Tonight. You ready for me to start writing that intro again? Or you just start, okay. Just trying to get your attention. Your mic isn't on. Play the intro again.
I can't do that again.
People just sit there in silence.
Well, I'm sure they heard that your mic.
Wow.
It's time for WDW News Tonight with Tom Corliss and Nicholas Cicero. Tonight on the show, we continue March Madness as we talk about the backstories at the park. Yeah, we have psychotic comments, of course, and much, much more coming your way. And now, here's your host of News Tonight, Tom Corliss.
Remember that time you did the whole opening and your mic wasn't on?
No, I don't.
Hello, I'm Tom Corliss, and I have a few scruples now. Eric's mic just flew off of him.
Oh.
Pete's running around with sub sandwiches. Your mic isn't on. All of these backstories are out of order. Things are going great.
Well, I was trying to remember what else we had on tonight's show. I mean, I think we have the backstories.
It's mostly just March Madness, which will take 17 hours. So
psychotic comments is good tonight too.
That's good. Usually it's not, so it's great.
Ouch.
Thank you for joining us this evening. Please hit that like button. And if you haven't, please subscribe for more genuine content and the occasional nonsense like this, and to hear rumors that the Walt Disney Company will eventually denounce, and then I'll have to snap back at.
That doesn't happen.
No, never. They never lie at the Walt Disney Company. Now the news!
News!
Brought to you by the WDWNT Interglobe Society. No?
Always.
There's no news intro. Get that?
There's a news intro?
There's a news intro, yeah. Wow, this is going great. I'm just going to go at this point. After 2 years, concept art is finally leaked of the Moana presence at Walt Disney's Enchanted Tiki Room, and I can't even argue that this time it does look like I made it. It's really bad. My favorite Facebook comment today was, this was made in Photoshop. And I go, no, I'll read the article, it's real. They're like, yeah, but it was made in Photoshop. I was like, yeah, sometimes they actually use Photoshop.
It's a tool of the trade.
It's a professional program.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I've seen better art in an iDrive hotel room, personally. The art shows the entrance with a Moana sign and flags down the usual tiki room entrance. Once this project was canceled, all those flags were repurposed by Advent Health to be used at the temperature check locations. Those are them.
I've seen better art in an OBT hotel room.
There's no art in OBT hotel rooms. That's just
splattered. That's not
just
art.
The walls are just splattered with various.
I sit there
various bodily fluids.
I sit there admiring all the colors on the wall.
Oh, the OBT chunk. What is that? He's just like, this is a very interesting Van Gogh.
Very abstract.
It's like in Ferris Bueller when he stares at the art. They just keep cutting back and forth. Well, the pre-show would have been covered with the face of Tafiti, sealing Clyde, Claude, and likely myself inside the fountain permanently. In my efforts to save Clyde and Claude, I'd be sealed in. Luckily, of course, it would just be a decal, the face, so I would punch my way out. It'd be fine. When we reached Disney for comment on the art, they said a little lawyer bird told them to plead the fifth. There's the lawyer. Jose, attorney at law. Bird attorney. Oh, my litigations are getting shorter and shorter. Thomas Smith then went back to selling magical hair growth elixirs from a wagon.
Wow.
You get what you deserve. Interventions West has now been completely demolished at Epcot. When reached for comment, Disney CEO Bob Chapek remarked, "And let this be a lesson to those thinking of adding any more innovation to this park."
That'll show them.
You'll see. Of course, it's being replaced also with Moana. That concept art not made in Photoshop. It was done in Premiere. They tested the fountains on the Harmonious barges in front of guests this week. And guess what, everybody? It didn't hide them.
What?
So, you know, we were thinking about this. You know, obviously Disney's in a lot of trouble right now between getting caught in lies and building whatever this is. And, you know, they couldn't come up with a good way to hide these. So we came up with some ways to hide these barges. You guys want to see them?
Yeah, I'd love to. What do we got?
Are they photoshopped? Let's see. We came up with some ideas. Let's see what we got here.
Oh. Photoshop crashed. We can't pull them up right now. Yeah.
Things are going great. Well, I hope no one wanted to see them.
No, I really want to see them, Tom. Don't tease. Yeah.
We don't know where they are now.
Oh, is this one of those things where we show them later in the show to make them stay tuned for commercials? Is this?
That's it. Yeah. We're actually going to take this time to count the votes for the first round of March Madness. This is what I get for having a good morning. What happens? The show.
No, it'll be a good tease for later on. Yeah, just like other comments or something.
Should we wait? Do we have them? We have some of them. Oh. Okay. Can we see the first one? We could paint them go away green.
Oh, love it. The green monster.
Do that, yeah? Yeah. Mark McGwire hit a home run right through that. Yeah. Also, that's what used to poke him in the behind was those arms. That's how he would take the shot. All right, so what's the next one? I could buy you as much time as you need on these. Go to the next one, though. Any order. Doesn't matter. Just
water
go.
Water looks really blue.
You could roll those bushes in front of them.
Yep.
Look, it's trying to wave at us from behind. Hello.
Still here.
I like that even the bushes wouldn't hide it. All right, next one. We have the Leva Legacy
Balls.
Those are the ones that we can't find yet. That's where they are. They're out in the lagoon. Oh. That's why we can't find them. Yeah.
Good place for those.
We can move the clown slide face from the boardwalk resort out in front of them. Still the arm is still out.
You can slide through the barge, then through the clown's mouth. Yeah. Love it.
Next one. We could use Wakandan technology to hide it. But we can't use that same technology on an actual Marvel attraction, which is in the background, though. They don't, those two don't intermingle. Those aren't two of the crossover ones. Someone could hold up an iPad in front of it. That's probably what'll actually happen during the real nighttime show. You could play Mars Needs Moms.
Oh, yeah.
On it.
Good place to play that.
That'll be the most people that have ever seen it. Just the second they turn this on, it'll be the most people ever seen Mars Needs Moms. More of these? You could tell the Disney executives how much this thing costs, and they'll have it removed.
Bob's like, stay calm.
So I know we save money by not driving them, but how much does Stargate cost? Oh. I like the guy in the back on the phone. You could actually just drive them away. That's an idea.
That's something.
Yeah. I don't know.
Whoa!
We could put rockets in them.
Like the pineapple.
Emilio Estevez.
He's on that, yeah.
Out of the park, yes. And I think we're... Oh, that one we didn't see yet. You could put tapestries with the art of what you're supposed to see. That way it looks like almost it's not... It's a pretty open mesh. There's a lot of big holes in that mesh.
Mm-hmm. Come on, the wind, you know.
We have one more, is that right? John Cena can say, "You can't see me," in front of it, and it'll disappear. Which is what Lauren's trying to do that right now. She's trying to vanish. After forgetting to load these in. All right. Let's move on.
Will that bought us some time?
Back time for what?
I don't know. We're
already behind schedule. Backlot Express released a new dessert recently, which is an adorable paint can confetti cake. Say that five times fast. The Italy booth at Epcot got word of this and immediately started selling Valspar pies. All the people who work in construction at home are rolling on the floor right now. That was Eric's construction joke of the week. Peaches laughed from the other room.
Gotta collect them all.
After a year of waiting, Disney's All-Star Movies Resort will reopen as scheduled on March 22nd. You know, in case you're interested in catching something worse than COVID. Get out home for the All-Stars. It's a perfect hotel for me because I love COVID. Legacy pass holders at Downtown Disney could grab a free signed Raya and the Last Dragon lithograph. It's nice. Well, it was nice at least until you turned it over and saw what they put on the back. This art was created as a publicity stunt by a company with mostly white, mostly male management who hope to keep their jobs. We hope you will tell your friends about how inclusive we are, even after we took your annual pass away from you. Get your list home. Yep. Eight more women are currently suing the Walt Disney Company over rampant gender pay discrimination and are now claiming, on top of the lack of true pay equity, pay secrecy has also played a large role in the discrimination at hand. It's not like Disney to keep secrets. It's really not like them at all. Disney released additional statements about these allegations, claiming that, quote, "We are sorry the judge is being fed incorrect information by unscrupulous sources. We will continue paying our female employees just as we have since 1971. Disney announced that James Cameron's Avatar is once again the highest grossing film of all time at the global box office, recently surpassing Avengers Endgame. While there was a China reissue of Avatar in theaters recently, it turns out the numbers were just delayed as some people were just finishing the movie. Over at Universal Studios Florida, team members have started seating every row on the E.T. Adventure. This should speed up the line, so guests wanting to ride this may wish to take their edibles sooner in the queue. That's the news. Who brings us the news?
This program and many more are brought to you by WAKES, the WDWNT Interglobe Society. Support WDWNT to get early and exclusive access to content you can't find anywhere else, including exclusive post shows for WDW News Tonight and Park Center each week, exclusive programs detailed and ride rehab watches, access to our Discord community, and much more starting at just $2 a month. For more information, go to patreon.com/WDWNT or visit WDWNT.com and click the Patreon link. Join WAKES and help make this and other shows happen.
Yes, thank you. Thank you to the WAKES. And remember, starting April 1st, our post show moves to the $7 level of the WAKES program. All right, we're going to take a commercial break. When we come back, we're getting right into it, the start of March Madness. When we return, stick around tonight.
From Disneyland Resort President Ken Potrock, it's time for the candy every Legacy Passholder will crave.
Potrocks!
Pod Rocks are colorful, flavorful fun that you'll be hooked on once you get just a touch of it. Just rip open a bag and let the fun begin. Sometimes you get candy, and sometimes, well...
All I got was 30% off my next Pod Rocks purchase.
What a deal! Makes you forget that you didn't even get any of the candy you paid for.
Not really.
Pod Rocks come in four financially conservative flavors. Angry former pass holder, canceled pass, park still closed, and ruby grapefruit. Watch out for the angry pass holder bag. It's really bitter. Pod Rocks, they'll leave a bad taste in your mouth. And no, it's not a drug thing.
Hi, I'm Thomas. And before I start a hard day of writing for the Parks blog, I need a hearty breakfast. That's when I reach for a bowl of my favorite cereal, Unscrupuloops.
Oh, can I have some?
Sure, Bob. You like it?
It's a little hard.
That's because Unscrupuloops is full of nonsensical toys.
Oh, good. Toys are my barrier to entry when it comes to breakfast cereal. No one buys Cheerios or Rice Krispies unless there's a toy in it.
That's right, Bob. No one will eat a world-renowned cereal when you get something crammed with recognizable things that are truly horrible.
Yeah, we should just throw all of our Cheerios away. It's garbage.
Well, Bob, the other people in the house might complain if we do that. They really like Cheerios.
Well, I guess I don't want everyone to hate me. We can keep the Cheerios, but I'm for damn sure throwing out all this Captain EO Crunch.
That's fine, Bob. We can get away with that one.
Okay, I'm gonna get some ketchup and some pickles, and I'm gonna finish this in my room.
Unscrupuloops is filled with bird and bear-shaped oat pieces, mixed with hard toys like Lego bricks and Tinker Toys. And if someone in your house doesn't like the toys in the cereal, just take them out quietly and just tell them they were never there to begin with.
Is that Corliss guy dead yet?
Yes, Bob. It's better to just lie to him, too.
Unscrupuloops are part of a complete public relations disaster.
In an effort to streamline the theme park experience, we at Disney are unveiling a new version of the Walt Disney World Vacation. Faster, more efficient, perfect for those with limited days off. It's Disney's Park Express service. A trackless ride vehicle will pick you up at Orlando International Airport. Just stow your luggage where we would usually put a droid. Your transport will then whisk you down I-4, past our beautifully repainted arches, to the Walt Disney World Resort. Your vehicle will use a priority access lane to go through temperature checks and security before taking you inside each park. At each park, the Unthemed Personal Conveyance Holding Acceptable Rich Guests Express, or UPCHARGE for short, will skip ahead of ride vehicles at our most popular attractions, taking you through all of the park's experiences in record time.
We rode everything in the Magic Kingdom in 45 minutes. It turns out the time you actually spend on rides in a given day doesn't amount to much.
Upon arrival at your second park, the upcharge can break in half, with the front half pulling up to the urinals, while the back of the car pulls into bathroom stalls. You might want to seat the missus in the back. Then, it's a quick breeze through all three rides at Epcot. Following your second park, a Hollywood Brown Derby meal will be served on board as you travel beneath the Skyliner path to Hollywood Studios. Then, it's time for all the rides in Hollywood Studios in under 15 minutes. Sadly, the upcharge doesn't have spring action shooters for Toy Story Mania, but you can just pretend to sling webs with Tom Holland instead. Last but not least, the experience ends at Disney's Animal Kingdom, culminating in a trip on Expedition Everest. On the trip home, the upcharge will drop you off at the World of Disney store to shop, and you can grab a bite at Disney Springs.
Okay, but how do we get home?
That's your own problem. Disney's Park Express service begins at just $3,999.95 per guest. You can also upgrade to Park Express Plus, which gets you through all of the rides at double the intended speed. Walt Disney World Resort.
Money, please. Come on, you.
This is where the early planning is taking place for our so-called Disney World project.
It is a showplace dedicated to entertain, we hope, with a purpose.
The biggest celebration Walt Disney World has ever seen. It's 50th anniversary.
Those new commercial throws are great. I love those. Those are much better than that damn banjo music on Splash Mountain. That was the worst. I hated that. This week on Disney Plus, what's happening? At Universal Studios, the Osprey and the Velocicoaster this week on Disney Plus.
Oh, man. Boy. Wow.
Yeah, watch Zemo. Oh, he's still there.
Yes, he is.
He lives there now.
I have my friends with me.
You have all your bird friends.
Yeah.
Come to me, my forest friends!
These are the only ones I can touch. Apparently, I can't touch the Osprey.
No, it's legally you cannot. Yeah.
But legally, I can touch an orange bird as much as I want.
Wow.
Sometimes that's a little too much. Still sounds creepy.
According to Disney security.
It's been a very bird-centric week. A lot of stuff with birds. Anyway. All right, let's start.
Yeah!
Budding, 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 budding.
Sorry, I get excited.
Welcome to March Madness, our second tournament of 2021. This tournament is a very interesting one, certainly I think more interesting than any we've done before. It's going to be weird and wild. It is Disney Parks Backstories, whether they be from an attraction, a restaurant, a store, a hotel, a land, whatever. What are the backstories that Imagineers have created through the years that are indelible, that we think are super cool, or just the most memorable and endearing? Joining me, an illustrious panel, obviously myself and Nick. Here in the backstage area, we've got Eric Morton.
I'm back.
Oh, yep. And Pete Carney's here.
Ah, see my co, everyone.
It's a good shirt.
I know, I like
that
one.
It's not a Carousel product shirt, but it's good.
They're in the wash.
They're in the wash, yep. Joining us remotely, we have David Smith.
Hey, everyone. Good to see you.
Marcy Smith back with us.
Hello.
She blocked Alice with a fern, and that's Alice's face. Oh dear!
Alice was.
There's a fern in my face. And then someone who we wish had a fern in front of them. It's Spencer.
Oh.
Arigato gozaimasu, Spencer. Where are you? You in Amity?
At the Amity Landing restaurant, Jaws is right there.
We are. This is all right. That's acceptable. If he's going to have lag, I prefer it to be with the backdrop of Jaws. That's great. All right.
Lag is universal.
Lag is universal. Yep. All right. Let's get started. What is the first? Well, I guess first we should explain how this works. I don't know what he said. That's going to be annoying. What do you want to explain how it works?
Yeah, so we have multiple rounds, just like March Madness, the basketball tournament. We have seven panelists here, and we will debate the best backstories at the Disney parks, and then we'll each vote for the one we want to move on to the next round. Our votes on the panel are worth 5 points each, but of course, You, the listeners who have registered to play March Madness with us, can call in. And Lauren, can we remind people of the call-in phone number so they have it? Remember, you could call in and sway the vote if you have registered. So you have a register code. So if you registered, you got an email with a code. Make sure you give that code. Your vote is worth 2 points. So you get enough votes, you can sway things and get your backstories further in the game, win more points, and then win some prizes at the end.
Core bucks for prizes.
Core bucks for prizes, exactly. So everybody gets a vote in the first round, and then you get one vote in the later rounds, which we'll do next week. So we'll do round one today, and then rounds two through the finals next week.
So you get one call each week. Next week, it doesn't matter what round you can call.
Correct, that is correct.
All right, let's actually get started, shall we? What's up first? The Twilight Zone Tower of Terror. All right, so as we show these images, I'm going to read the backstory to you. So this will take longer than last tournament. Don't worry, everyone. We'll be out of here in 3 hours.
Don't worry, we'll vote quickly.
The Hollywood Tower Hotel opened in 1919, but on Halloween 1939, five passengers stepped aboard an elevator and into the Twilight Zone. They were lost. The hotel was abandoned at that point, and obviously all sorts of things, both in the attraction and even down Sunset Boulevard, point to that the hotel has been abandoned. These are going to be just the gist of the backstory. Certainly, we could talk more about these, but for time, we're going to keep it simple for some of these. Some of these I will have to talk for a while. Versus, is it this one? Rock and Roller Coaster Avec Aerosmith. So I have to go searching for the other one now. This is, of course, the Disneyland Paris version, which, believe it or not, had a different backstory. Guests entered a building themed to the fictional Tour de Force Records. The story focused on Aerosmith working with engineers to create a revolutionary new music experience at the studio. After watching a pre-show which features Aerosmith, Steven Tyler hyping up the ride and sort of designing the roller coaster, guests are lured into the testing area where they board one of the sound trackers, a prototype vehicle for a new type of music experience. Very experimental. This is out there. This is the wackiest backstory. But Pete, why don't you start us off? Which one of these is better? What do you like better?
Well, since Jason is not on the show this week, figured someone has to have and explain how they're going to vote. One of these are in America. No, I'm just kidding.
No. I would literally throw you out of the room.
The Twilight Zone Tower of Terror is going to get my vote. It's just one of those rides. I have never seen the Twilight Zone, but yet I love this attraction. I've also never seen X-Files, and I sometimes mix the two up.
Oh, boy.
However, I think, and you'll see this as a theme with backstories all throughout my bracket, is if you can tell a complete story and most people get it, without having knowing anything about the ride or the IP, which in this case is the Twilight Zone, I think it's a home run. So Twilight Zone Tower of Terror getting my vote.
Eric?
Yeah, I think the Twilight Zone Tower of Terror has a little bit more depth to it. Really, the rock and roller coaster Avec Aerosmith is some story you could tell in, you know, a superficial, quick story in any theme park. Maybe not quite up to the detail and immersion of Disney. So I'm going to go with the Tower of Terror.
Marcy?
I am going to definitely agree with the Twilight Zone Tower of Terror. I mean, the Twilight Zone is a classic, and I really like the backstory. It's incredibly immersive, and it goes really well with the attraction. So I'm definitely going to choose that.
David?
So we're going to talk about Tower of Terror a number of times during this. I'm not going to even mention it. That's my vote, by the way. But I do want to just mention Rock and Roller Coaster. It's simultaneously the most boring backstory and the craziest backstory for that attraction. Yeah, you're designing a ride. Of course, it's a ride. That's what it is. But one of the rules I have in life, I have very few, but don't ride something that's designed by Steven Tyler. And the other thing is, in the official wording of the backstory, it says that guests are lured into the testing area where they then board one of the vehicles.
Steven Tyler.
You don't want any backstory that has you being lured into something.
See, I told you, Nick. Spencer, via satellite. Oh, he's a mask on now.
There's people. So I definitely have to go with the Twilight Zone. Well, you know what? It's hard, okay? I try to do a lot for you right now. I definitely have to go with the Twilight Zone Tower of Terror. You know, I agree with David. Don't ride on anything that was designed by Steven Tyler, number one. But also, despite having never seen the Twilight Zone, it still feels like a much more compelling story. It feels much more fleshed out and detailed. When you walk into the lobby at the Hollywood Tower of Hotel, you're just swept away, and you can really feel like you're in that world. I don't feel that as much when I look at Rock and Roller Coaster, either one of them.
I say we just get whatever the family votes on behind him every time. It's so expensive.
Spencer, next time I cut back, you better have that Jaws hot dog. Nick!
I'm all for luring guests into an experience, a testing area. That sounds pretty cool. But I mean, that's a weird premise. I mean, I like the immersive premise of the the Rock and Roller Coaster at Hollywood Studios. You know, that just makes more sense. It feels more right. This one feels kind of just like we want to do something different when making this up. So it has to be Tower of Terror. I mean, that's one of the more immersive backstories, of course.
Tower. Yeah, I vote Tower. Let's move along. Next, it's 35-0. Next matchup. Oh, Maharaja Jungle Trek. Hold on, I have to find that in my papers. Here it is. This is a good one. The trail is themed as if it had once been the hunting grounds for a wealthy Maharaja who enclosed the forest to allow for easier hunting and then sometime later died in a hunting accident. God, he got what he deserved, just like the Disney PR department.
Oh.
The theme storyline continues with subsequent Maharajas, including the original Maharaja's bachelor brother, transforming the area into a nature preserve where the villagers live in harmony with the animals therein. These Maharajas are memorialized on the walls of the tiger enclosure. The forest was at one point also run by Imperial British visitors, as evidenced in the Western spelling on the sign at the entrance of the Jungle Trek, which reads Royal Anandapur Forest. It's spelled differently. The Asian animals include tigers, Komodo dragons, blah, blah, blah. We don't know what's in there. But this is a really interesting backstory. There is a homage to the founder of the Kingdom of Anandapur, Anata, in the form of a tomb and sarcophagus situated at the entrance of the Jungle Trek's aviary. That's Maharaja Jungle Trek. Next one. Soaring Fantastic Flight. We're set at the Museum of Fantastic Flight in Porto Paradiso, which is presenting a retrospective on the life of Camelia Falco, an aviation pioneer and the first female member of the Society of Explorers and Adventurers, or SEA, from the early 1800s. She developed the Dream Flyer, a glider inspired by the flying machines imagined by Leonardo da Vinci. The spirit of Falco appears to guide guests to the Dream Flyer and takes them on an imaginative flight of fantasy all around the world, utilizing a modified version of the existing Soarin' Around the World film. Okay. These are both very good. I like these a lot. Spencer, just pick Soaring. Let's get it over with. Come on.
You know, I appreciate that you know me well enough to know that I'll pick Soaring because it's true. But, I mean, seriously, when you walk through that queue, think of all the props and the details and all the little things that you see as you're walking through the Museum of Fantastic Flight. I mean, you were there on opening day. It's absolutely incredible. I can't compare that to Maharaja Jungle Trek. Come on.
Okay. David?
I'm going with Soarin as well. I love aviation, so that's right in my wheelhouse. The only thing I'll say about Maharaja is there is an awful lot of death involved with Animal Kingdom.
Marcy?
I'm going to also go with Soarin Fantastic Flight. I hadn't really heard either of these backstories, but that one sounds much more interesting.
It's a good way to judge them. Pete?
So sticking with my theme of just kind of bringing it to the understanding of your guest, I have never been on Soarin'. I've never been at that location. However, it does sound like this gives you more of, I think you get it more. Like, I've been on the Maharaja Jungle Trek many times. I did not know almost any of this backstory at all until we started doing this March Madness. So I think since I didn't even know the backstory and I walk that jungle track all the time, I'm going to go with Soarin.
Mr. Dak.
Eric? I am Mr. Dak. This is hard.
I'm kind of like Pete. I did not know. I didn't know this backstory for the Maharaja Jungle Trek.
No.
It sounds really cool. I think tonight we're going to see like a recurring theme, which is a lot of stories where there's a rich guy that does something and then he pays the price and then that's the attraction, right? So
that started in the monologue.
yeah.
Bob.
I really like that idea. I didn't know this. So the guy sets up like, basically like he rigs a hunting camp that's walled.
And
so he just
hunt, and then he dies in a hunt.
It's hilarious, right?
We're gonna get a lot of this. Hunters are evil. He died.
I was looking into that pitch room with like Joe Rudy. He's like, all right, what do we think about Maharaja Jungle Trek? And it's like, we should kill the guy.
I don't want to drag this out, but I think one thing that's worth pointing out is this is a great storyline, but I don't feel like this storyline is applied to the guest as part of the attraction, right? Mm-hmm, it's just something for lore that you don't even know about. The Soarin' Fantastic Flight, clearly the story is told throughout the attraction. So I'm going to go with that, even though I have not been there.
Mm. Yeah.
Nick?
Yeah, they're both rich stories. One of the things that I'm going to try to do in this tournament is separate, like, the ride itself and just try to put myself, if I heard this story, which ride would I be more enticed to want to go on? Uh-huh. And it would definitely be Soaring in this case.
I got to say, Maharaja is my favorite trick to pull out when if I'm taking someone to Animal Kingdom for the first time. I love to pull that story out. And my favorite is the three stone murals before the, you know, when you're about to go in the aviary, there's there's the part with the windows to the tigers with that weird snail rock statue thing. Right outside of there, there's a wall. So there's the doors, the wall there are the three stone murals and they teach the story. Like, he's the hunter, Mother Nature like fights back, and then in the third one they live in harmony with the animals. It gives you story, but again, it's not overt. It's very much a thing you have to look for. I think it's wonderful, but this is a sea attraction, and I'm picking Soarin'.
I was gonna say anything
because it's sea.
That's what I was voting for.
It's 35-0. But Maharaja is very good. It's a shame that got blown out. I think against a lot of other things, Maharaja would have won.
Oh, definitely.
For sure. All right. What is the next matchup?
By the way, real quick, just to let you know, the bracket is updated online if people want to check it out at wdwnt.com/mm.
Oh, we got that.
Yeah, it's great. It's up there.
All right, next up, I got to dig through my papers. Oh, boy. The extraterrestrial alien encounter. An evil corporation called XS Tech visits Earth and sets up their technology on display at the Convention Center, the Interplanetary Convention Center in Tomorrowland. As explained by the company's chairman, C.L. Clench. They want to show off their new advanced teleportation technology to humans after a flawed demonstration by the robot, Sir. Guests are shown to a chamber with the large teleportation tube in the center, seated in a harness, and the demonstration begins with Clench and two scientists. Of course, they are trying to send Clench there, but obviously they're a big evil corporation, and lots of bad things happen because they are a big evil corporation. Yes. All right, what is it up against? It is up against Storm Rider.
Riders on the Storm.
Here we go. Located on a shore not yet known in a time yet to be, Port Discovery is a vision of a unique tomorrow, a time when science and nature are in balance. So the Maharaja of Port Discovery doesn't die because everything's in balance. It is the home of the Center for Weather Control, where scientists from around the globe are gathered to probe the intricate workings of Earth's weather. They are engaged in sensitive research and experimentation with one goal in mind, to control severe weather systems such as tornadoes, hurricanes, and typhoons, which are all the backstories for everything else in this tournament, by the way. To that end, they have designed and built a new type of flying weather laboratory known as Storm Rider. Aboard the airborne weather research stations, scientists are able to locate, analyze, and combat the planet's most devastating storms. To celebrate the success of Storm Rider and the arrival of a bold new scientific era, the center is hosting a festival and open house. That's where you come in. Mm-hmm. So here we go. Both sciencey places where something goes horribly wrong. Eric, what are we going with?
So Alien Encounter has this really original trope of a powerful person doing things they shouldn't do and getting what they deserve.
People with money again. Yeah,
people with money, doing these things they shouldn't be doing. The principal from Ferris Bueller's Day Off gets it, you know, does all this stuff, turns into aliens. He gets arrested and goes to prison. I've seen it 1,000 times. I'm going to go with Storm Ride.
Wow. Pete?
That's surprising. For me, I know I already voted with Tokyo once, and it's hard to vote for Tokyo twice. So I'll keep this one short. I honestly do believe the better backstory is Alien Encounter.
Yeah. Nick?
Yeah, this one's simple. You're telling me one I'm going to see an attraction about weather, and the other one I'm going to go see dangerous aliens. They're sitting side by side. I'm walking into the dangerous aliens building. Yes. Definitely.
I am clearly also voting for Alien Encounter, as if there was any discussion. All right, Spencer, pick Storm Rider. Let's move on.
You know, as offended as I am at Pete for not wanting to pick Tokyo twice, I actually have to go with Alien Encounter.
Oh!
That family's attacking you. Look behind you. God.
Wow.
No, I'm playing dumb. Anyway. I think that Alien Encounter definitely, as much of a trope as that backstory is, I think it's a much more rich backstory, and it's demonstrated so well in everything I've seen from the Cube, and generally linked together in the whole lore of the attraction, I think, for Alien Encounter. I have to pick that. Also, Storm Rider is kind of lame.
All right, David?
Yeah, I'm going with the Alien Encounter. It's a unique story within the Disney world. It's, you know, darker than most. That's it.
Oh, dog.
Yeah.
Marcy?
I'm going to go with Storm Rider because I really did not like Alien Encounter. Those harnesses.
Point.
It came down on my shoulders and I couldn't move. I just did not like it. I felt very claustrophobic.
David, does she go on any rides with you?
Small world.
We have the kids. I don't need to go with them.
Well. Do the kids not go on anything?
No, I'm saying the kids can go with him. Oh, you just, I can shop.
You're outside like Spencer, just sitting at a table.
Someone's got to hold the bags.
Okay. What's the final there? That was close, right?
No, not that close. 5-2. So what is that? That's 25-10.
Oh, okay.
For Alien Encounter?
Keep making your jokes, and the merch I've bought so far may happen to find its way into Amity Harbor.
Did you get my plush cake?
Yes.
Yes. All right. Next matchup, please.
Putting in orders on the air.
There's a limited edition plush cake.
No.
Yeah.
What's it celebrating?
The opening of Super Nintendo World.
Oh.
It has all the characters and it's on a cake.
Oh, gosh.
Fantastic.
Can you grab two of those?
It's $500. No,
can we see the next matchup, please?
I gotcha.
Yeah.
Spencer's gonna walk out of there looking like a Sherpa.
Tom pays me well.
Illuminations, Reflections of Earth. It's the story of us, the story of mankind and Earth. It goes from the Big Bang through to, you know, the creation of nations, the creation of different technologies, and eventually the culmination of the Millennium Celebration where all cultures celebrate hand in hand. It's very sweet.
That's not a backstory. That's just the story of the show.
That's literally a backstory.
Look how small that globe looks.
The ring would be up to those white fireworks, I believe. What's the next one? Ooh, Storm Along Bay.
How did these get seeded against each other in the first round?
Storm Along Bay. Explorer Storm Along used his boat, the Albatross, to sail the Northeast Atlantic. A huge nor'easter came. Remember when I told you storms are most of these?
Mm-hmm.
A huge nor'easter came and blew his ship off course, permanently running it aground in its current location. Luckily, he landed at a yacht and beach club.
Good steering.
There are much worse places he could have landed.
The All-Stars?
Yes. His butler was the one who informed him he had run aground. The pools are actually made from the boat being drug through the sand, scooping out the holes. So that's how that was made, by the boat. And if you look, you see the pools are connected, or at least appear to be, because they're again supposed to be caused by the boat coming ashore. That's Storm Along Bay. That was also when they first opened. You could actually swim with fish. But then very quickly the fish were dying, and they got rid of that.
Usually you have to piss off an Italian guy to do that, right?
Well, you know. Oh, boy. Spencer, you're in the location that most looks like this right now, so why don't you go first?
I think I have to go with Illuminations, honestly. It goes back to what we were talking about with Maharaja Jungle Trek. I feel like Illuminations, it definitely links you into that story, whereas with Stormalong Bay, you don't really get that. You're just swimming in a pool with sand.
Okay. Marcy?
I'm actually going to go with Stormalong Bay because I agree that the Illumination story is more of the story of the show, and as you know, instead of like a backstory, whereas like Stormalong Bay, that's the story of how that all came about. So, and I love Stormalong Bay.
But Illuminations is the story of how we came about. It's literally our backstory.
Preach, Tom. Preach.
Pete, go next.
100% Illuminations. Now, granted, this matchup, it's a shame because Stormalong Bay is awesome. I love that backstory. I think it's incredible. It should have gone way deeper in the tournament. But Illuminations, Tom, you know, finally hitting the nail on the head at something in life, nails it. I mean, like, it literally is the story of us. There are no other backstories without the backstory for Illuminations. I mean, this has got to win. I mean, and in terms of it being the actual story, that is the show. Like, otherwise the backstory would be like, a long time ago, barges were floated out underneath the bridge. And, you know, like, so
a long time 2:00. Ago, a big, mean, stupid executive was put in charge of Parks.
Well, that's the thing, too, is that you'll see these with a lot of other, like, stories. Like, you have to have a backstory for Stormalong Bay of how it got there. We know how the fireworks, the story is the backstory. I mean, Illuminations, my pick all the way forward going through. Let's go.
Eric?
This is actually hard for me because Stormalong Bay has like a specific backstory, tells you how this stuff got here, a specific incident. Illuminations has a very broad backstory. It's like, oh, it's the story of man and the earth. Like, that's pretty broad.
It's a show about the millennium. I mean,
right,
it's just,
I get it.
But, you know, I still think it's a compelling story. I like the way that it's told as if you're sitting around a fire.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's pretty cool. I feel bad for Stormalong Bay. I'm going with Illuminations, though, but it is a hard choice.
David?
Yeah, I'll talk more about Illuminations next round. That's my vote. It's amazing. It's amazing how much better Illuminations looks every development we get in World Showcase.
Yep. Sure does. Nick?
It's a shame to vote out, like, if we do vote out a really good backstory for a pool, because that's a pretty interesting story to have on here.
Of course you think so.
Well, it is. Oh. Wow. No, but that's just me looking for my glasses, and that was my path I looked.
That's how you did,
yeah,
got dug out.
That's how I dug, like, it out, yeah.
Looking for your glasses.
No, but, all right, so Eric kind of touched on it. The key to the story of Illuminations is gathering around the fire, and with that as kind of the story of why we're gathered around these torches and this lagoon to hear this story. That's really why I'm voting for it. This is one of those that's really hard to separate the story from the love for the attraction itself, but I still have to vote Illuminations.
I think once you know the backstory, you appreciate Illuminations so much more.
Yeah.
And I think the other thing is, the backstory for Stormalong Bay isn't that apparent either. Like, you know there's a shipwreck. There's nothing that tells you really why. Like, you could kind of piece together, I guess, Hurricane Hannah's, be like, oh, I guess it was a hurricane. Meanwhile, it was a nor'easter anyway. Whatever. Yeah, I'm going with Illuminations. Illuminations. Mm-hmm. All right, next matchup.
Was that a shutout?
No, 30 to 5.
30 to 5.
30 to 5. Marcy was contrarian, as always. what's next? Big Thunder Mountain Railroad. We're talking exclusively about all the non-Paris versions of this ride, by the way. Once a working mine during America's gold rush, there was gold found deep within Big Thunder Mountain in Red Rock Canyon. Almost overnight, the town of Tumbleweed became a thriving mine town. One Barnabas T. Bullion established the Big Thunder Mining Company to go after the gold. Barnabas was born a powerful East Coast family, rich guy again, so naturally he thought it was his very right to claim the gold inside. Well, the mountain had other ideas. Big Thunder Mountain was said to be protective of its gold and would curse anyone who dare try to take it. While in operation, miners would hear ghostly sounds and believe supernatural powers inhabited the mine. Strange events would occur, including cave-ins and equipment failing. On one very stormy night, a flash flood completely wiped out the town, destroying the mining company. Rumors have it Professor Cumulus Isobar, a rainmaker, brought the flood to Tumbleweed. If you look carefully, you might spot a mysterious machine with Cumulus's name on it while experiencing the ride, at least in Florida. Nowadays, Big Thunder Mountain Railroad travels through an empty ghost mine. That's how the trains run, the spirits driving the trains. It's worth noting, this is a combination of the original backstory, which was more Native American based, and that's why they rewrote pieces of it, and the backstory that was introduced with the refurbishments at Disneyland and Disney World in the last decade. So there you go. What is it against? It's against the New York Deli.
Oh, yeah.
And Tokyo Disney Sea. So this takes up like a whole city block, the New York Deli. The idea is that the deli kept expanding as neighboring businesses collapsed around them. Rather than convert the interiors, they left them as is. So there's actually an Irish pub that they just used for additional seating. There are various companies that work in Broadway. So there's a company that makes backdrops and stuff, and they just have dining tables in that area as well. The location is favored by performers at the nearby theater. That is because most of the performers live just above the New York Deli in those apartments that you can see there. So there's a lot of influence of the neighboring theater on the New York Deli. Spencer, as our resident of Tokyo, why don't you go first?
I might have to go with New York Deli explicitly because they have the best Reuben in Tokyo, probably in all of Japan.
The best what?
The best Reuben.
Oh,
that Reuben sandwich
Lord,
is good.
Please.
Are you kidding me?
What does that have to do with the backstory?
Please. You think that's a good...
The backstory is good.
Everything at the New York Deli at Disney Sea is as if, like, I called someone in Japan on the phone and then tried to explain to them what a sandwich is. And then it's like... And that's what... It's like, yeah, it's this, this, and this. Okay, and it's just like, oh.
And then more bread on top?
Hey,
yes, more bread on top.
Say what you will. Say what you will about the Reuben, but my best friend, he grew up in New York. He's been here for 15 years. He knows what a Reuben is supposed to be, and he says it's the real, authentic deal.
Do you mean he grew up in Unork on the planet Zork? Is that... Maybe you were confused.
I'll introduce you to him the next time you come. New York Deli, let's move on.
Wow. Marcy.
Okay, so I love New York. I love the theater, and I'm really missing it right now because of everything going on. And it kind of sounds like a little bit like Chelsea Market, where there's a whole bunch of stuff inside, and it's like one big building. I love, you know, to think that there's a bunch of different things going on. So I'm going to go with New York Deli, and I love Reuben's.
Wow. Nick?
Only one of these backstories was amazing enough to have a 5-part comic book series created about it. And that is not the New York Deli. That is Big Thunder Mountain. So I am voting the railroad.
There you go. We're not even mentioning, like, this story goes so much deeper. Like, Barnabas T. Bullion is a C member, by the way. And beyond that, Jason Chandler worked for the Big Thunder Mining Company. Made his money, and once he made his money, he left the Big Thunder Mining Company to found a new town called Discovery Bay.
Oh.
And of course, he never made it, but that's the thing. Like, Big Thunder is so steeped in lore that connects to so much of the other park attractions. New York Deli is, if we were doing themed interior March Madness, New York Deli's the winner. New York Deli wins the whole tournament.
Better than Pizza Rizzo?
Yeah, oh yeah. Absolutely. No, I have spent time fighting for tables and individual rooms in New York Deli because I was like, I haven't sat in this room yet, and I want to see this room. It's amazing. But that's not a backstory. That's an interior. So I'm going with Big Thunder Mountain Railroad. Pete?
All right. So For me, I think the story of Big Thunder is incredible. And they and I think if it was Q and overall ride experience and which I preferred to do, it would be Big Thunder. But I don't think you get any of that backstory unless you really research it or know someone about it. You don't pick it up walking through the queue. If I asked, I'm sure 90 out of 100 people coming off the ride.
Sound like you're from the New York Deli.
Yeah. So I'm just saying, so I mean, the New York Deli, to me, just looking at that photo and hearing you explain it, I get all that. I get that the entertainers are coming in from downstairs. It's a very New York thing to not even like change the space. Let's just use this for seating because it's available. You guys go over here. It just, I feel like you get the backstory a lot more clearly on with the New York Deli. So I am going to go with, for ease of understanding, the New York Deli.
Wow. Eric.
So Big Thunder Mountain has this interesting story. The premise is creative because there's this rich guy, and then he does something bad, and something bad happens to him. And we all appreciate hubris like that. It's almost like Imagineers from the past are trying to speak to Disney CEOs of the future about what happens when you're too greedy.
Oh, man.
The thing about New York Deli is it does, I mean, I think it's a cute story. It's a cute setup of how the place came to be. But it doesn't have, like, characters, as far as I know, that are interesting, that have a lot of depth to it. It's more Umbrella Academy. He's got a whole block of buildings, right, where they knock out walls in between him until he has something that's like a mansion, right? If you saw Umbrella Academy. So I get it. I like the idea. But Big Thunder, I mean, the depth of the storyline and theme and everything is far beyond. Here's an explanation why this room's an Irish pub and this one's a boutique. Yeah. So I'm going to go with Big Thunder.
David?
Yeah, I mean, Big Thunder is so surprisingly deep. I've got to go with that one. It has very little equal in terms of backstory. New York Deli, to me, just feels like a food-based Walmart, just preying on failing small businesses to grow bigger. So,
ouch.
Food Walmart. All right, Big Thunder Mountain Railroad, 20-15. That can easily be swayed. What's the next matchup?
Boo.
Just yell boo. Star Tours, The Adventures Continue. If I can find the script for this one somewhere. Here it is. According to the opening crawl that preceded the attraction's inaugural opening, after the dark times began, Captain Antilles had dispatched C-3PO and R2-D2, who were placed in the custody of Antilles by order of Bail Organa near the end of Revenge of the Sith, to assist in the inauguration of a space line. The seemingly close relationship between the Rebel Alliance and the Star Tours Agency caused the Galactic Empire to believe that both entities were in partnership and has since monitored the agency's actions over the years. So this is, they developed a whole different backstory. Not only do we have we're going to talk about the backstory of it being an airline. That's coming with regular Star Tours later. We're judging solely the new backstory in this case that was made for the second version of Star Tours. What is it up against? Jock Lindsey's Hangar Bar. Man, I wonder what everyone over there is going to pick. I can't imagine. If I ever find Jock Lindsey's Hangar Bar, I'll let you know what it is. Here it is. Story of the Hangar Bar builds out Jock's character, giving him a pass as a seasoned circus pilot turned adventurer. Of course, Jock Lindsey from the Indiana Jones film series. He's in the very first film, Raiders of the Lost Ark, where Indy yells at him, Jock, get the plane up, and Snake Reggie's in the plane, in case you've never seen the movie. Spoiler alert. Later on in his life, he made his home at Disney Springs, falling in love with the place when he flew over Florida in search of the Fountain of the Youth. Instead, he opened a bar, which is chock full of memorabilia from his past. It's the story of Pete's life. Once the storyline was established, the Imagineers were able to add authentic details to the bar, from collections of aviation parts to diver bell that families can actually dine inside, to Reggie Jock's canvas-covered steamboat named after his pet snake are all here. So, yeah, Jock Lindsey's versus Star Tours, The Adventures Continue. I'm going to lead off. I'm going to go with Jock Lindsey's because Jock Lindsey's was such a good backstory that everything at Jock Lindsey's was a tremendous disappointment after, right? Like, they never lived up to the hype.
No, they never
like,
did.
All I said was, Indiana, we announced this, remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Indiana Jones theme bar is coming to Disney Springs. Okay. And they're like, it's Jock Lindsey's hangar bar. And we're like, oh, yeah, this sounds great. And they lay out this story. We're like, this is fantastic. Oh, my God. And then we go there and we're like, oh, okay, it's not as fun as we thought it was going to be. So the backstory is almost better than the real thing.
Yep.
It sounds better as a concept than it does in execution. So I'm going with Jock Lindsey's. Nick?
Yeah. He has a very similar story to Sir Montague, who, as we know, we found out a couple weeks ago.
The balloon guy.
Founded Aerofile, yeah. Yeah, I mean, again, if I'm just hearing these stories side by side, I'm much more excited for Jock Lindsey's hangar bar to go in there, have some drinks in this themed atmosphere. Sounds much more fun. By the way, it's fun. That, like, did we? I don't know if we did this on purpose too. Lucasfilm like properties up against each other, kind of here.
But just happened.
Yeah, Jock Lindsey's.
David.
Yeah, this one's tough. I appreciate the backstory of Jock Lindsey's, but the execution I think was poor. I got to go with Star Tours, even though I appreciate that they tried to place it in the timeline and then completely ignored that with the attraction itself. But I'm still going to stay with Star Tours on this one.
George Lucas famously said, who cares? Marcy, that was a real thing he said.
No.
Marcy.
Okay, considering Dave's never actually been to Jock Lindsey's, he can't really talk about the execution. But anyway.
Wow.
Was
it because you don't let him go to Jock Lindsey's, though?
Boo this man!
Of course not. We have kids like with us restraints. Normally. We don't really want to bring them into a bar. But anyway. I'm definitely going with Jock Lindsey's, even though I haven't been inside. I love the backstory because I'm a huge Indiana Jones fan. I love Star Wars, but I love Indiana Jones more. And I actually think Harrison Ford was better in those movies.
I don't think anyone's going to disagree that Harrison Ford was better as Indiana Jones than Han Solo, no?
Yeah.
Nah, probably not. Yeah. I never thought about it before, but I'd probably
think
of him as Indy.
But he doesn't have to carry the whole movie in Star Wars either.
Yeah.
Right?
As someone who has seen at least one Star Wars film and one Indiana Jones film, he's definitely a better Indy.
Wow.
I never thought about
that. Pete saw Indiana Jones 4. Knives Out. That's the subtitle on that one. Indiana Jones, Knives Out. who didn't go? Spencer.
I've never been to Jock Lindsey's, but the backstory definitely sounds better, and you all hit those points already, so I won't repeat anything. Jock Lindsey for me.
Peter?
I will save my Jock Lindsey spiel for the next round, because this obviously has to move on. Jock Lindsey.
Eric.
I'm the same as Pete. I was like, if Jock Lindsey's doesn't make it through, I'll feel bad because I have a lot to say about the backstory of Jock Lindsey's, but it's Jock Lindsey's.
All right. What's the next matchup? Welcome to Toontown. As the story goes, after Mickey Mouse became a star in 1928, he found the perfect home in a quiet residential toon suburb away from the hustle of Hollywood. As one would expect, Mickey's friends also decided they would enjoy the secluded neighborhood and moved in as well. Because of his popularity, Mickey knew he and his friends would continue to film cartoons, so rather than commute to Hollywood, he constructed a small movie barn behind his house so he and all his friends could continue to make their cartoons without leaving their burg. It's believed that when Walt Disney was looking for an area to build his amusement enterprise in the early 1950s, Mickey suggested the fields of orange groves surrounding his neighborhood. The only request he had was that Mickey's Toontown be kept secret. They agreed, and Disneyland opened nearby on July 17, 1955. Mickey, Minnie, and the other Disney characters could say hello to all the families visiting and then retreat back to their homes as soon as the park closed for the day. Years later, in 1990, the residents of Mickey's Toontown gathered and made a very important decision. They decided they wanted to open the gates to their secret hideaway to non-toon guests. How cute.
Oh, my goodness.
Don't tell me you didn't know that.
They didn't.
Wow. What's the next one? What's it up against? Virtual Jungle Cruise at Disney Quest.
Uh-oh.
This is wild. I didn't even know this. Apparently, on the original sign for this thing, it mentions Wayne Szalinski. So what's happening here... There was a pre-show, apparently, with Wayne Szalinski also that wasn't there later. I don't know. I missed this. So Wayne Szalinski from Honey, I Shrunk the Kids has lost a gizmo, and he needs you to help him find it by going back through time to the age of the dinosaurs. This is the backstory to Virtual Jungle Cruise.
Now it makes sense.
Yeah.
So yeah. There's an attraction where you travel back in time to see dinosaurs?
Yeah.
Sign me up. Does this exist anywhere
Wayne
else?
Wayne Szalinski, not rich, though. Not rich. Yes. Eric, why don't you start us off?
Well, as we know, Mickey's Toontown starts with a rich mouse. No, I like the Toontown. The cool thing about Toontown is it sounds like what I would do if I won Powerball. Yep. Like have just a neighborhood where me and my friends could make movies and do stuff.
It's kind of what we did.
And Mickey was a little late to desegregation by 1990, I'm glad he got there. I had the opportunity to do Virtual Jungle Cruise. It was junk.
It was kind of
stupid.
Twice.
It's got to be Toontown.
Right off the bat, two times. It was broken. It kept deflating, so I kept flying off the back. What did you pick?
Toontown.
Go ahead.
Again, I think this should run away with it, but Toontown is just the perfect backstory. I think everyone gets it. It fits the story, it fits the land, it all makes sense. It is a backstory that is logical, and unlike the other one.
Zelensky lost his gizmo. Yeah. You have to go get it from a dinosaur.
I'm going Toontown all the way.
Nick?
I'm within punching distance of Lauren. I'm voting for Virtual Jungle Cruise. I'm very afraid.
Why do you care?
Of what
Disney
might happen.
Because it's Disney Quest?
I love Virtual Jungle Cruise.
She loves Virtual Jungle Cruise. Is that so you're picking?
Yeah, it needs some love. That's a cool story.
That's fine. Toontown is one of the greatest backstories ever. I'm voting for Toontown. David?
Yeah, Toontown. I mean, Virtual Jungle Cruise just sounds like they pulled cards out of a hat.
Marcy?
Yeah, I love Toontown. It's a great backstory. It makes so much sense that like the characters would live there and then go back to their homes. I love it. So definitely Toontown.
Spencer, is there a different backstory for the Tokyo one, or is it the same thing? Like they had a town in Tokyo? I don't even know.
I'm pretty sure it's the same one. Just because they cloned the land and just turned it around, it's probably the same backstory.
Okay.
I'm going to get yelled at by Lauren on Slack for this. One of these is good and coherent and makes a lot of sense. And the other one is Virtual Jungle Cruise. So I vote Toontown.
All right, that's 30. That's 30-5 for Toontown. What's the next match? And then we're done with this region. Ooh, McDuck's Department Store. This is one of my favorites.
Yes.
Named after and owned by Scrooge McDuck, the department store actually tells the story of Scrooge McDuck's success. He began with a pawn shop on the, not this side of the building, it's actually the back end of the building, in a worse neighborhood. It's a less, you can see architecturally, it is a less, it is a more impoverished neighborhood. He starts with the pawn shop. As you get to the middle of the store, the facades get nicer, and you have his next business venture, which is a wholesale shop. And then finally, that very ritzy-looking end is when Scrooge McDuck has made his fortunes. This is Scrooge McDuck's department store. And it's this progression of he continues to expand, and you can see the story. As you walk through the store, you see the story of Scrooge from his beginnings in business to the point where he literally could build a fountain out of gold coins outside of the front of the shop.
Are there more expensive gifts on that side of the building?
No, it's all Duffy, so it's all expensive.
Oh, okay.
All expensive. Spencer, go. We didn't even name the other thing. I'm so excited about McDuck's, which just win. What's the other thing? No, I don't even know.
It's going to be hard.
I'm going to fight with all of you.
Forget it.
Pleasure Island was an abandoned industrial waterfront district that was converted into a nightclub complex. Property was originally owned by Meriwether Pleasure, a seafaring adventurer who, during the 19th century, operated Pleasure's Canvas and Sailmaking Incorporated. His business becomes the heart of Pleasure Island, a place to which daring adventurers from all over the globe came to tell their incredible tales. But Meriwether was not a landlubber at heart, and hearing these stories made him long once again for the adventure on the seas. One day, he heeded the haunting call of the bounding main and set sail from Pleasure Island. Upon learning that their father was lost at sea, Pleasure's two lazy sons abandoned the business. The once bustling waterfront district was left to decay beside a mysterious lagoon. Years later, the near ruins of Pleasure Island rediscovered by adventurous Imagineers with their own incredible tales to tell. The Imagineers refurbished the island, turning its rundown warehouses into exciting restaurants and nightclubs that were designed to reflect the original themes of Pleasure's functional buildings and be discounted on Tuesdays for cast members. Once again, the district bustles with the activity of world travelers who come together in the spirit of fun and adventure, a tradition established here a century ago. I'm going to start us off. I like the Pleasure Island backstory a lot. I really like McDuck's, and it's told so beautifully inside the shop, the very old style pawn shop, the wholesale, and then the department store is beautiful, and then the art on the walls, which is in that very Carl Barks? I always forget the guy's name, the artist who did the all of the original Scrooge art. And it's all it tells the story beautifully. I'm going with McDuck's department store.
Why did you seat it 15 then?
Because I knew people didn't know what it was.
But if it's such a great backstory, why?
The way we make the tournament is I ask a large group of people, what do you think are the best backstories? Those automatically get seated. The first thing people mention gets seated highest. So if a multitude of people bring up the same couple of things, those get seated high. Things people don't bring up, I then have to seed towards the back. McDuck's department store is one of those things I had to seed towards the back.
I guess I get it. You're going based on your recognition or how knowledgeable people are of it. I mean, I kind of understand, but here, and you explain it beautifully and eloquently that it sounds awesome. Like, I hear this, I'm like, wow, that sounds really cool. I'd love to go see how this guy kind of came up and see the theming inside. And it's a good backstory, but nothing beats Pleasure Island. I mean, Pleasure Island is such a great backstory. And like it's so deep that it's like they didn't even need the front half of the story. They could have said Disney Imagineers just found this area and make it. They could have used the same story, but the fact that like they have all these characters and then the Imagineers come and like take it over. I really love the backstory. I think it also matched everything that went on there. I think it's super cool, and I like that a backstory involves Imagineers. I think it's neat.
Imagineers found this abandoned area and put an art of shaving in it.
That wasn't a pleasure.
So McDuck's. Here we have a story with a poor character who works his way up, screwing the little guys over by pawning their stuff.
Yeah,
I think it's a really cute story. I'd like to go there one day. Pleasure Island is one of the deepest, most interesting backstories in this bracket. It's stories within stories. There are things within Pleasure Island that are their own.
We have a
competitor
them,
in this bracket.
A couple of them are busted out. Yeah, Pleasure Island, Adventurers Club, and Rock and Roll.
So I won't touch on those because they have their own themes. But you could mannequins, right? When I was a kid, what was mannequins? I don't know. It's a dance club with a rotating dance floor. No, that dance floor rotated because they built locomotives, a special locomotive in there. And they need to turn around, right? The neon armadillo of a country bar has a theme where it used to be where he like raised cacti. And then when they found it was full of armadillos, and you know, like it, the backstory of Pleasure Island is super deep and rich. Yeah. I hope it makes it to the next round because I have an awful lot to say. But in the interest of time, I'm gonna hope that it makes it through and go ahead and just say Pleasure Island.
Awesome. Nick,
yeah, Pleasure Island by a mile. We'll keep it short there.
Spencer.
This is actually hard. I recognize how deep the Pleasure Island backstory runs, but at the same time, I love McDuck's, and I love how much attention to detail goes through showing Scrooge McDuck's story.
Congratulations!
I'm so fired for this, but I'm going to get fired for this, but I have to go with Pleasure Island. I'm sorry.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, they're both great. I'm not offended with anyone's pick. Marcy?
So hard to beat that.
Marcy?
Yeah, I think if I had the choice to go to one right now, I'd choose McDuck's, but I do think that Pleasure Island is probably the better backstory, so I'm going to go with Pleasure Island.
David?
Yeah, you know what, Tom? I think you've convinced me. I'm going to go with McDuck's. Let's see if the audience feels strongly enough to go with it.
I don't know. I just have a soft spot for a guy who worked his way up from a poor section of New York working in like a pawn shop. And then eventually makes it big. It's just something about that story that connects to me.
Because you love Chumlee.
Started as a predatory lender and worked his way up to Walmart. Yeah.
Now, granted, Meriwether, Adam, pleasure, you have this rich guy.
Never mind.
All right, that's that is the end of the first region.
Fourth of the way through.
So remember, the phone lines are open. We're going to leave them open for a few more moments. Let's show them the number again. It's 8327-WDWNT7, 8327-WDWNT7. We're going to close voting on this region in a few moments. While we're waiting for you to call in, I'm going to pick up this a piece of paper. Because it's time for March Tragic.
Yeah, it is.
This paper's tragic now. For those of you who are unfamiliar, March Tragic is our tournament of really wonderful t-shirt ideas that Disney would never make. And so because we would make them with the carousel products, we're all voting and trying to pick what's a great shirt idea that Disney wouldn't make, but we will. And we'll actually make it. That's the plan.
Yeah.
So let's put up the brackets. Let's show people what we got going on.
Ha! Love it.
They're just my sheet. No, someone wrote. It's my sheet scanned? Is that?
It's your handwriting.
I was going to say, it's horrible. I wish someone would have told me they're going to scan my sheet. All right, so the first matchup is Innoventions Through the Years. Remember, this idea has like Communicore, and then Innoventions with the Neon, and then the next version of Innoventions, and then like Rubble.
Yeah.
That was the idea for this one. And then Nick's Maxivan Service.
Boy.
Nick's Maxivan Service versus this Innoventions Through the Years. So what does everybody think?
Maxivan. Just shout
100%.
What do you say? Maxivan?
Maxivan, 100%. I think it's funnier. I think it's more of an inside joke between
what
us and our
fans.
What
would you buy?
Nick's Maxivan way. Oh, but I also because I don't like shirts that end and that are sad. I don't want a pile of rubble on my shirt. This is bringing someone a sad memory. Nick's Maxivan, if you know what we're talking about, that will bring a smile to your face as you see it in the park.
It does not have as broad an appeal as the Innoventions one, though, right? We'll sell more shirts to people that don't watch our show if we do Innoventions. Is that fair to say?
But if there's like a pile of rubble at the end and they like sand shirts.
People are a rich guy in one of these Backstories one day.
I can't go against Maxivan. Too many people in the chat want them.
Nice.
Yes.
Fine. That moves on.
Underdog. Right.
The Epcot Skyline shirt, which would have the harmonious ring and the big box and spaceship bird.
Yeah.
And all that stuff. Versus the It'll Always Be Lake Buena Vista Shopping Village to me.
Ooh, these are both good too.
I'm going to vote Skyline because the other one was kind of Innoventions kind of thing didn't get in. I think the Skyline's good.
Yeah, I agree, Epcot.
It's more relevant right now as well.
I don't know. I can't see it as well. I mean, I love Epcot. I love all those things, but I'm just. I like nostalgia shirts, so I'm going Buena Vista.
The chat is all Skyline. All Skyline, so we're going Skyline.
All right,
we've got the most scaled-back celebration on Earth. See, I can't read my handwriting. The most scaled-back celebration on Earth versus Walt would be disappointed. These both have tell me two shirts that have the same energy.
I was going to say, two shirts perfect for Tom.
I was going to say, can we just put one phrase on the front of this shirt and the other on the back of the shirt?
The wall thing's funny, but it's not a shirt. I don't.
I like the scaled back.
Yeah, I love that.
I think the scaled back is not quite as mean.
Scaled back is
also not quite as mean.
And I can envision a cool logo.
The chat
that we can create.
Walt.
No, I just don't want to see that in the parks either. I don't want to see Walt be disappointed while
I don't
want to
see it in the parks, even though it's true.
It just. I mean, if that's what the chat's going with.
The chat is, I can't even, like,
it just
argue.
Feels
the
like
chat is all
boring. I don't know what the is. Are we going to do a cartoon wall on it?
No.
Because it's just going to be the words. And to me.
This is tough.
Scaled back.
Scaled back is funny.
Either way, I think this loses in the next round, so I don't care.
Probably more what the people want in the chat, so.
Yeah, the Walt.
They're both sad.
All right. Because money. Versus 12 flags.
12 flags.
Oh, this is a
12 flags over Epcot.
These are a couple heavyweights.
I would wear 12 flags.
12 flags.
Yeah. Oh yeah. The people are gonna want because money. They've wanted it for like eight years.
The chat is flags.
Oh really? Nice. All right.
That's an upset,
also, I think
man.
Flags, 12 flags. Also, if they see you wearing that in the parks, they're gonna be like, "Oh, that's funny."
Yeah.
And because money, you have to be a fan of us. A stranger would just be like, "I don't get it." Is it because? Like, I don't get it.
All right, well, that's it for this week. We'll do the rest next week. We'll finish it off. We'll find out what shirt, throw it back all on the right. floor, what shirt gets made next week.
Nick's Maxi Van got in the final four. I feel a little proud.
Regardless, I'm making that shirt for myself.
It was also in the final four cars impounded last night in the Orlando area.
I think it would be helpful. Like, the Knicks maxi van is great, but I got to see the artwork.
Yeah, for sure.
Right? I have to see the artwork before I make a decision on that one.
And we can't do that. We got to develop the artwork. That's the challenge. Yeah. Man. Nick.
Yes.
Are the phone lines closed?
The phone lines are closed.
They are closed. Do we have any score updates?
Let's find out.
We're going to find out if we have any score updates. Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet.
One.
We're doing some
just
math.
Just about now.
Nick's doing. Watch Nick do Let's math live. Live math.
If only we could have lowered a calculator.
Nick's there.
Lauren broke on live math. I don't know why that wasn't that funny. All
right. Smash that like button.
Hit the like button, please, for 4 hours of tournaments.
Hooray.
We could have spread this out over 8 weeks. But we instead decided to give you just a bunch of really long shows.
Turns out March is only four.
Well, usually it one tournament fills the whole month, but this year we were like, nah, let's just go for it.
All right, so we got a few calls.
Hit the noise. No, shouldn't have it. No, people are still not going to get it. Never mind, just go ahead.
There are no changes.
No
None
change.
Of the votes affected
no
any
change.
Outcomes.
All right. We don't need
the first part of round one.
They're mostly blowout. There weren't any close matchups. Really.
All right, then no. You know what? Let's keep going. What's the next matchup? Just forget it. Just go to the next matchup. Just forget.
It's already midnight.
Forget it. Oh, boy. I'm going to have to hear these people now. Here we go. Well, this sheet's done. Let me find Expedition Everest. Oh, this I can
yes.
throw this sheet away.
Yes.
That sheet's
yes.
done.
You don't have to read it. This should win the whole tournament.
Should win the whole tournament? I'll get to it at some point. I don't know where it is. Next week, we'll put these in order.
Expedition Everest.
People go to Everest and do some stuff at Everest.
The Yeti decided to join
the Yeti swipes. The Yeti is, of course, a seal member.
By the sea.
Made a fortune building or selling prayer rags.
The adventure begins. Oh. I like this backstory better than
We do have a super chat while you're looking, Tom. $4 for 4 hours from WDW.
Thank you. Appreciate it. The adventure begins in Asia as a guest joins the Expedition Everest team and embark on a trek through Anandapur. The trail leads visitors to the village of Sirkazong, which I believe was also a Star Wars character, which means Fortress of the Chasm. In the early years, the Royal Anandapur Tea Company shipped its tea by train from Sirkazong through the Forbidden Mountain Paths, but the railroad was closed after a series of mysterious accidents, rumored to be at the hand of the Yeti. Today, the village of Sirkazong is thriving and has moved beyond its tragic past, largely thanks to the effort of local entrepreneurs. In spite of the local opposition, the Himalayan Escapes Tours and Expeditions Company has partially refurbished the railway, now offers transportation for adventurers to the base camp of Mount Everest. There you go. And what is it up against? The people mover.
He just never stops moving.
That's not the back. No, that's not even what we're talking about. Don't worry, you have five
it
minutes to make
people.
Fun of it until I find it.
Look, people over there. Now they're over here. It's up in the sky.
I'm so confused with these papers now. I'm so lost.
People living in H21 think about
man.
Tomorrow.
Here it is. The TTA, we're talking about the Tomorrowland Transit Authority's backstory in the 1994 to 2009 version of the ride, made reference to the Transit Authority's three different lines, the Blue Line, the Red Line, and the Green Line. The Blue Line, which constitutes the actual ride, was Tomorrowland's intra-city elevated train system. The Red Line took riders off-planet to other destinations in the galaxy, while the Green Line provided local transportation to Tomorrowland's hoverburbs. There was a diorama of a hub station where all three lines intersect, located on the second floor of the North Show building. Other services provided by the Tomorrowland Transit Authority, interstate highway maintenance, and long-distance space travel were alluded to in the ride's narration. And, of course, there was even an ad for Pan Galactic Pizza. along the way.
Shut this up, Robert Moses.
So Everest versus the Tomorrowland Transit Authority. Nick, why don't you start us off?
Okay. Yeah, one is like a story about, hey, transportation lines, master planning, ooh. The other one is taking me on a mountain journey to see a, you know, like a creature that's lurking, that's destroying villages, and has all this lore. Definitely Everest.
Just have static statues.
Definitely Everest. It's not about the ride, it's about the story.
That's
and
true.
Again, you
that's
put those
fair.
Side by side, I'm going to
that's
see
fair.
The Yeti.
That's fair. I'm picking the TTA. Growing up in New York, I don't know, just the idea of like public, fake public transportation.
Public transportation.
I love fake public transportation. Over. And like the fact that there's like all these overhead announcements for different lines and connections. And then you actually see the connections in that diorama and just that whole storyline of like you're on the train, like going somewhere. I don't know. I just thought it was really cool. To 94 Tomorrowland was such a great story. And this was the attraction that best gave you that backstory of the whole land. So that's why I'm going with the TTA. Eric?
Yeah, I love the idea of, you know, Tomorrowland's not just like a land in a theme park. It's like you're a citizen of it. So it's a city. And how does it solve real city problems, but with like transportation? I think it's a really cute story. I just don't think it approaches, I love it. I just don't think it approaches the story of Expedition Everest, which is a little bit more immersive, a little bit more adventurous, a little more exciting. So I'm going to go with Expedition Everest.
Yeah, I mean, Tom technically was voting for Everest too when he said he likes fake transportation. That is part of this backstory on top of so many other things. I mean, yeah, this, who cares?
I don't want to ride
and
the T-train.
And it doesn't even solve a problem. It's not even about transportation. What is the problem solving? T-train. Hi, I want to get on a platform here, but then I just want to be back on the same platform in a few minutes. Can you move me, or can I just walk the 10 steps? It's nothing against the rides. We're not pitting the rides against each other. We're pitting the backstories. And, I mean, this whole backstory of Everest is incredible. It all checks out. It is played through not only on the attraction, but the queue. You get it. You understand it. An amazing backstory, Expedition Everest.
David?
Yeah, I really like how Everest unfolds over the course of that queue and through the attraction, so I'm going with that. And it's ironic that the cause of those mysterious accidents itself became a victim of mysterious issues.
Marcy?
Yeah, if you ask me which one I would rather ride, it's going to be TTA every time. But as far as the backstory goes, I think that the Expedition Everest backstory is so immersive. And you could see like the amazing amount of detail. I mean, I don't even know how many times you'd have to go through that queue to see everything. There's just so much, and they did so much research and put so much into it. So I'm definitely going with Everest.
Spencer?
I don't understand the hate behind Expedition Everest, honestly. I always thought it was fun. But there's just so much detail and love shown to the lore and to the culture of Nepal shown in the queue for Expedition Everest. Like Marcy said, it would take forever for you to just go through and see all the details and every little thing in there. I gotta go with Expedition Everest, as much as I love references to Pangalactic Pizza Port.
Am I the only person who picked?
Yep.
Everyone went? Yep.
One is the
30-5 for Everest. Ugh.
Yeah.
I hate Everest. All right, next up. Oh, Sid Coengas. Sid Coengas at the Disney MGM Studios, or Disney's Hollywood Studios, right there at the base of Hollywood Boulevard. Definitely not buying time while I look through. The story goes that Sid Coenga and his wife moved from the Midwest to Hollywood in the 1920s. As the movie industry boomed around them, their Hollywood property became valuable, and real estate agents tried to purchase the couple's house. Being big movie fans, however, the Coengas refused to sell. Instead, they capitalized on tourists who passed by their home, with Sid deciding to make some extra money by showcasing and selling movie memorabilia that he'd collected over the years. Versus Space Mountain, I cannot pronounce it. De la Terre de la Lune? Where's Axel this week? Guests enter the mountain and were ushered inside the queue known as the Stellar Way, where they would get a look at the coaster itself, but they would reach a Victorian chamber of the Baltimore Gun Club, the club which built the giant cannon outside of the ride. This cannon would, of course, be used to shoot riders to space. That's right. It's based on From the Earth to the Moon. Yeah, you board a copper and bronze train, and the Baltimore Gun Club's giant cannon shoots you into space. Yeah. There's a line sometimes. You weren't there when there was a line. Nick, why don't you start?
Space cannon!
Space cannon!
Sign me up!
Eric?
I'm going to pass right by the Guns in Baltimore thing and just say I think it's really...
It's based on The Wire.
It's based on The Wire.
Oh, yeah. I'm so ready to say that.
But like the Jules Verne steampunk cannon that fires you into space. I love it. I love the aesthetic. I love it all. It's great.
What'd you pick?
Space Mountain de la Lune, whatever it is.
Pete? Listen, it's cool. It's funny. But we have to be realistic. This is why we need some logic on this panel. Yeah, it's a space cannon. I don't think that backstory is that interesting. Jules Verne's cool and all, but you don't get it all. I mean, the Sid Kuanga is it makes sense. It matches the storyline of that street. It's totally understandable to the average person. Everyone gets it. It gives it a reason for being there on Hollywood Boulevard. It makes sense. It's perfect. It's cute. It's quaint. And it's perfect. It's a perfect backstory for that area.
Marcy?
Yeah, I'm going with Sid Coingo's 100%.
David?
Yeah, Space Mountain is, I like the Jules Verne overlay of it, but I got to go with Sid's. It's just a great theme for a shop, and the fact that for a long time you could actually meet Sid when you went into the store.
Yeah. The actor who played Sid passed away. They decided never to recast the role, which was very thoughtful.
Good choice.
Yeah. Spencer?
Space cannon.
Space cannon. I'm going with Sid's because the story inside, you could kind of tell that story, right? It was just someone's house. You could tell by there was all this movie propping, but there's also just a clock on a mantle in between racks of autographs. Like it was someone's house.
Literally like your apartment.
Come in and buy stuff. I love it. There was a character that actually walked around, and just everything about Sid's was beautiful Disney storytelling. Not that that Space Mountain was not amazing, but Sid's is fantastic. What was the voting there? I don't know if I have this tallied right.
Three Space and four
it's
Sid.
It's 4-3, right?
Yeah.
That's correct.
Ooh, Sid's winning.
That was correct. Yeah, that was close. Next matchup. Oh, boy. So, this is, we're going to talk about Port Orleans Riverside. This is really long. Here we go. In since Dixie Landings, the original name of the resort, was settled in three distinct phases. First, there were trappers who found the area a convenient gathering place to meet with those merchants willing to venture that far up the Sasagula to purchase their prized pelts. Then, in a story that is often as much legend as fact, mysterious and reclusive Everett Pierce became the area's first permanent resident when he established his isolated home of Old Man Island. The place that has become Dixie Landings was established largely through the efforts of the outgoing and ambitious Colonel J.C., who saw the locale as an ideal spot for a cotton mill serving Louisiana's growing cotton industry. Hardly out of his teens, young J.C. married Millie, his longtime sweetheart, and the two moved away from Port Orleans to seek success and happiness. By the way, Port Orleans at the time was French Quarter. This was Dixie Landings. At first, J.C. and Millie were shunned by the many trappers who haunted the abundant bayous, but the colonel had no interest in infringing on their swamps. He had his eye on the higher, drier land round the river bend near Old Man Island. Captivated by the lush grasslands and spectacular stands of stately trees, he claimed a modest stretch as his own, dubbed it Magnolia Bend, and set about building both a mill and a mansion. Though it took some years, the colonel's dreams were destined to come true. The home he constructed for his expanding family grew slowly into a stately structure known as... Oh, boy. Where does this continue? I don't even know. I'm lost again. Oh, boy. It's here somewhere. We're doing great this week. Doing great. I don't find it. It's a weird name. It's
right. You're only a short bus ride away to Tiana's Mountain.
You know. Yeah.
Mount Orleans.
Someday I'll find this.
Buford Honeyworth.
Acadian House.
How do you just jump back in?
The Colonel's ancestors among the first settlers in Louisiana had hailed from Nova Scotia, which also was called Acadia. The old blend of English, French, and Indian words, which crept gradually into their speech, eventually shortened Acadian to Cajun, the name by which we know their descendants today. In testimony to the quality of craftsmanship that went into it, Acadian House serves as a welcome home away from home to many, many visitors. Just as impressive as the Colonel's incredible home was the cotton mill he created across the river. With the dedicated assistance of a couple of dozen family men who had ventured north from Port Orleans in the Colonel's footsteps, a cotton press and water wheel weighing just over 35,000 pounds were built from local wood. That's, you're looking at it now. The screw gears, axles, and shafts were carved from white oak, and gear teeth were fashioned from hickory. The water wheel itself was Colonel's pride and joy for a very good reason. Far and away the most advanced machine of its time, it was designed specifically for Colonel J.C.'s mill by world-famous mechanical engineer and cotton expert Whitney E. Lai. Although, although today the Colonel's cotton mill serves as a dining hall for visitors to Dixie Landings, the wheel and indeed much of the mill itself remain just as they were in 1850 when, in full swing, they were a prime example of human ingenuity. The year was 1853 and change was in the air around Dixie Landings. It's like a novel. Colonel J.C. and Millie were anticipating the first visit by their eldest daughter, Sarah, who had gone several years before to Maryland to study economics. While there, she met, fell deeply in love with, and married Buford Honeyworth III, an enterprising entrepreneur from Virginia.
From the Country Bears.
This is my stage name, Buford Honeyworth III.
Oh, boy.
Who quite coincidentally had a number of thriving business interests in Baton Rouge. Buford, being acutely attuned to the times, had carefully considered the impact of the steamboat on life along the Sasagula. His business sense told him there was an opportunity to be pounced upon with the creation of transportation between Port Orleans and points north. Being himself somewhat familiar with the area and having heard Sarah's description of Magnolia Bend, he saw it as precisely the proper place to launch the endeavor. Buford and the Colonel took an immediate liking to each other. The two spent many hours discussing the value of increased steamboat travel along the Sasagula. The Colonel introduced Buford to his old friend, Sir Edward. How many people are in this goddamn story? Sir Edward Biltwright, an inventor and engineer of worldwide renown. After only the briefest negotiations with the mechanical genius,
can we turn this into a puppet show? This would be great.
Founded the Sasagula Steamboat Company next to the Colonel's cotton mill on January 3rd, 1853. The next day, Sir Edward departed for Pittsburgh to supervise construction of the Sasagula Steamboat Company's first vessel, the Dixie Queen. This isn't over yet.
Seriously, it's on another this sheet. Would be a great like puppet show miniseries.
Like a miniseries just to teach you the history of, of this.
Do it like a soap opera.
Buford Honeyworth.
We could have cliffhangers every week.
Oh, Honeyworth.
I want to see those from like Buford enter stage right.
Oh, man.
If I ever find the rest of this story,
would
be
so
good.
Good.
I don't know where the rest is. I have no idea.
Oh, here we go. Halfway there.
No, there's a whole other page. By 1855, Dixie Landings was a thriving town in need of goods and services on a grander scale. As though answering the call, a distinguished and recently retired Army officer, General George Fulton, arrived with his lovely wife, Amelia, and a typically tactical plan to open a well-stocked store. Buford Honeyworth, always the enterprising businessman, had become a virtual one-man Dixie Landings Chamber of Commerce and was eager to promote growth in his adopted hometown. He sold the general a prime portion of his own land next door to the Sasagola Steamboat Company at a very favorable price, and in mere months the doors were open to Fulton's general store. The general, a tall, thin man who nonetheless had all the bluster and bearing,
was placed at a rakish angle.
Military man
who walked with a slight limp.
This is great because this is what a story treatment looks like. This gives you an idea of what is written in the creation of not things today, but in the 80s and 90s at peak Disney.
Yeah.
Like, this is what they were writing for everything.
I was gonna save this for when we talk about it, but like you said, story wise, this is something I would love to watch on Disney Plus. Like, they have to tell the story. I would love to watch this.
Ken Burns style, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So good.
I'm gonna skip some of the Fulton story. Dixie Landing reached new heights with the arrival of Henry Lamarin in 1877.
We're like five generations in.
A Frenchman from Upper Louisiana with a real talent for floatables and a knack for knowing what would work where and when, Lamarin purchased a small strip of land next to the Colonel's cotton mill and moved his boat building company from nearby Notches. He saw the raw materials he required were plentiful around Dixie Landings and discovered a wealth of willing workers to get the new Lamarin and Company off the ground. The place probably became known as the Boatwright Shop, for that is indeed just what it was. A boatwright, you'd see, is someone who builds boats, and Henry and his men were the best in the business. Henry went out of his way to lure Louisiana's most skilled artisans and craftsmen up from up and down the river. With his in-depth understanding of the bayou and their supreme talents, they soon developed an entirely new kind of flat-bottom boat, ideally suited to the often shallow and difficult to navigate waters of the Sasagula.
The kink boat.
Wow. You know, soon the concentration of craftsmen and the invaluable new style of boat brought Dixie Landings a new level of respect. Boatwrights and just plain folks from miles around would visit the masters at work, and it was a heartfelt dream of many a young man to become a boatwright's apprentice in the prestigious shop. Today, Boatwright's Restaurant is home to the legacy of artisans who once worked here within its wooden structure. Its walls are adorned with the tools of the skilled trade, and hanging from the rafters is the Louisiana Lugger, one of the flat-bottom boats that brought Dixie Landing such acclaim. That's the backstory of all the major businesses at Port Orleans Riverside. What's that up against?
A gulch. That's Grizzly.
Grizzly Gulch. I have to find Grizzly Gulch now in my mess of papers. Someday I'll find Grizzly Gulch.
I want to see the Port Orleans backstory done in the style of Hamilton.
I would watch that. That'd be great. Wow. I'm not giving away my mill.
I mean, you expect me to leave without a reward? I'm going to call my uncle, Mr. Buford.
Oh, man. I hate that we have to do that now. I really hate that we have to write a musical about Port Orleans Riverside. I hate all of you so much. Not as much as I hate Grizzly Gulch, because I can't. What did you yell?
Here comes General Fulton.
Oh, wow.
I'm not giving away my pontoon.
Wow. Nope, that's not it. Oh, the problem is it's unlabeled at the beginning of one of these pages.
We got it together.
Oh, this is a very professional show we put on here at WWNT. Very professional.
I got it here, you want?
Do you actually have
it? Yeah.
Hold on, I've almost found it, I feel.
Starts with taking place in...
Yep. Yeah. Taking place in Northern California during the Gold Rush, Grizzly Gulch was founded on August 8th, 1888, believed to be the luckiest day of the luckiest month of the luckiest year. However, the early settlers of the region ran into misfortune as they discovered that they had built atop a geyser field. The old part of town is now called Geyser Gulch. Eventually, the town's luck began to change. Captain Phineas Cosgrove was exploring the mountainside and came across a family of three bears scratching themselves along the rocks. As they left, he found traces of gold, maybe, and staked a claim, starting the Big Grizzly Mountain Mining Company. As the mine grew, another amazing find came when a local stray golden retriever named Lucky sniffed out and led miners to a gigantic 150-pound gold nugget, now on display at the local office. These animals became beloved mascots of the town, with the family of bears given the names Rocky, Mother Lode, and Nugget being given protection in spite of them occasionally making trouble for the mine. These are both fantastic backstories, by the way. Nick?
Well, I can't vote for Grizzly Gulch based on one thing, because the date July 7th, 1777 has to be luckier than August 8th, 1888.
In their culture, 8 is the lucky.
Really?
Okay,
I didn't know that. Anyway, Port Orleans.
Peter?
Port Orleans, French Quarter. I mean, I wish we had...
Riverside.
Port Orleans, Riverside. I mean, I wish there was just a little bit more detail.
Port Orleans, Knives Out.
Xbox.
He was from Louisiana, the detective.
I hope this runs away with it, so I'll save time and talk more about this in future rounds. But if it's close, I'll start talking again. But yeah, Port Orleans.
Eric?
I love Port Orleans Riverside. I love going there. I love the theming. But the more I learned about it tonight, the less I liked it.
So, wow.
In particular, like, I legitimately think they should retheme it or rewrite this story that celebrating the cotton trade in the 1850s is, I think I can see where it would drag up bad feelings for people. And I understand it was a creative and well-written story. I actually also like the Grizzly Gulch story, so I'm going to go with Grizzly Gulch.
Grizzly Gulch. I'm also going with Grizzly Gulch. I love that. I love the Port Orleans backstory, but the story of the luck with the Bears, and you go down the bad luck mine shaft, and I don't know. The Port Orleans backstory is great. I love the story of the cluster of buildings in the front, but I don't.
You don't want to have to read it again next week.
That's also part of it. Yep. That's most of it, David.
Yeah, Port Orleans is detailed. You'll find evidence of that backstory through newspaper articles all over the place. However, I got to go with Grizzly Gulch simply because I'll just come right on and say it. There is no positive thing that can come from me, a white person, lending support to a theme of antebellum South. So I cannot go with Port Orleans.
Yeah, that's fair. Marcy?
Yeah, I'm
well, David
go
really made your choice easy.
No, that had nothing to do with it. I mean, as interesting as it sounded, like I kind of zoned out after like 3 minutes. If you have to like take a half an hour to explain the backstory, it can't be. I mean, no. So I'm just gonna go with Grizzly Gulch.
Wow, Spencer.
Well, David is right, and also anything that makes me listen to Tom talk in detail for longer than like 3 minutes is something that I can't support, so I got to go with Grizzly Gulch.
Yeah, Spencer's just such a quiet guy.
Wow.
Honestly, I would try and fight for Port Orleans and make more of an argument about it right now, but either way, this is losing to either Pizza Rizzo or Blizzard Beach the next round.
Oh. Yeah, Grizzly Gulch. I'm glad I read all that. Don't worry, I'm sure it's not the last you've heard of it on this show.
25-10?
Cannot wait.
Yeah. All right, what are the next backstories? Hopefully I can find them. Hey, Pizza Rizzo!
Hey.
The area near the entrance across from the ordering station features photographs and mementos honoring who appears to be Rizzo's father. For example, Papa Rizzo's apron from 1916 is on display. Photos featuring a Little League team named the City Rats can also be seen, along with a pennant and baseball bats in both human and rat sizes. According to a postcard on the corkboard upstairs, the Pizza Rizzo in Southern California is the second famous original Pizza Rizzo. So it can be assumed the first was opened by his father in New York. This is their second restaurant. Versus, oh boy, Blizzard Beach. This
is a good chilly, one. It's chilly, but you can go in the water.
What? Is this in New Orleans? Yeah.
Isn't it the same Gators? That
according
are
to Disney legend, a freak snowstorm on January 11, 1977 in the area led to the development of Florida's first ski resort. Ski lifts were put up, toboggan runs were laid down, and an entire resort area blossomed around the mountain of snow. Naturally, because of the normal temperatures in Florida, who would have seen this coming, the snow dissipated very quickly and rapidly turned into slush. This left behind a collection of waterlogged yet snowless ski jumps and chairlifts. The operators were preparing to cut their losses and walk away. However, they were interrupted by a loud yell coming from the summit of the mountain of melting snow and looked up to see a blue alligator sliding down the mountain at top speed. Ice Gator, the mascot, then landed in a pool of melted snow at the base of the mountain with a thunderous splash. The ski resort operator suddenly saw the park's, I don't know what they saw. It's on a different sheet. What did they see?
Buford coming down the water
it's
slide.
Buford. It interconnects with that. It's all related to that. Oh boy. This is great. We're doing great. That's Port Orleans. More Port Orleans. They saw the potential, and the mountain of snow became Disney's Blizzard Beach, the most slushy, slippery, exhilarating water park anywhere. The slalom courses, bobsled, and toboggan runs became downhill water slides. The creek of melted snow that formed at the base of the mountain became a relaxing tube ride. The chairlift carried swimmers instead of skiers. The ski jump became the tallest and fastest water slide in the world. Pete, why don't you start us off?
I think this is one of the hardest matchups in the first round. I think both of these are fun in different ways. Ultimately, what's going to get my vote is Pizza Rizzo. And it goes back to how you can understand and interpret the backstory without, for the average person, without being read it on the air. And I think when you walk into Pizza Rizzo, especially when you go upstairs to the wedding, and you have pictures on the walls, the caricatures, I just think the whole place tells the backstory without you really having to dive deep. I probably would have been Blizzard Beach if they didn't. I don't like that a blue alligator came skiing down and they were like, that's what we're going to do. We should build. I'm not a fan of Ice Gator. I know you are going to talk about it in short.
The worst.
I mean, Blizzard Beach, very cool story, but Pizza Rizzo has a special place in my heart.
Eric?
I mean, Pizza Rizzo's cool, I guess, if you like. If you like stories about tacky, like, New Jersey prom rooms or whatever, like,
rude.
It's themed like that. I don't know that this story is particularly rich. I like this story of Blizzard Beach. I like this story that it snowed in Florida in 1977. And it connects even to Winter Summerland next door, where Santa saw the snow and he and the elves built golf courses. The whole area, the idea of snow in Florida, it's kind of a simple thing to entertain kids, but I think it's a cute idea. I'm going to go with Blizzard Beach.
Nick?
Yeah, I'm with Eric. The theming in Pizza Rizzo is ridiculously good, but the story of Blizzard Beach is just really cute for a water park in Florida, and you can't beat that.
I am also picking Blizzard Beach because Ice Gator is the best and Pete is the worst. Marcy.
Is everyone else just going to say same?
No. Muppets Take Manhattan is my favorite Muppet movie. I love the whole scene in the diner where all of the rats are singing and dancing and cooking breakfast and everything. So I really like how Pizza Rizzo kind of ties into that. So I'm going with Pizza Rizzo.
Yeah, the diner / pizzeria. David.
Yeah, I got to go with Blizzard Beach. It's a great backstory. I mean, the backstory of the pizza restaurant is that it's a pizza restaurant. It doesn't add a whole lot.
Well, when you put it like that.
It is pretty boring. It's like, they opened another pizza restaurant. Here it is. There's a room that looks like every dining hall in the Bronx.
I really don't care about that, but like either way, Blizzard Beach is a great backstory. So like,
someone went to Maestro's on. Terrifying.
David.
What?
The backstory of a pizza place is that it's a pizza place.
It's so good.
It's not wrong.
It's so
Spencer.
Funny.
You know, there's only one thing that I anticipate needing when I go to Pizza Rizzo, and it's the number for the Department of Health. I vote Blizzard Beach.
Wow.
Blizzard Beach wins. Rightfully so.
Yeah, that's good.
Next!
Also, Ice Skater is the best, and Pete is the worst.
There you go. Time for me to go through papers again. What's next? The Haunted Mansion. And this one, you all just make one up. Pick whichever one you like for this one, because there's 400 of them. I don't even know which one to tell you, honestly.
Baby Powder Pete and Constance Hathaway.
We could talk about the one with the love triangle with Madame Leota. We could talk about the murderous bride. We can talk about all this weird stuff once I find it on this sheet somewhere. I'm never going to find it. I don't know. Who wants to tell the story of the Haunted Mansion? They don't want to tell it.
Well, you see, a long time ago, they couldn't decide.
A rich guy died.
A rich guy in a storm came through, or something like that.
It almost was the storm, right? It was the sea captain, right?
Owned by a company that was doing something they weren't supposed to do with money.
I don't think that was Haunted Mansion.
Can we tell another rich guy back?
Yes, it would be another.
Right under Blizzard.
Haunted Mansion. Many years ago, Master Gracie and Emily were engaged, but Madame Leota was also in love with Master Gracie. Leota believed if Emily were gone, Master Gracie would fall in love with her and they could be married. Madame Leota was left to haunt the mansion after she presumably died of old age. But again, there's a lot of different backstories here. I don't know. You could spin a roulette wheel and pick a Haunted Mansion backstory, probably. What's it up against?
MILF.
The Monsters, Inc. Laugh Floor. Oh, boy. This is gonna be exciting. Traction is set after the events of the Disney Pixar animated film Monsters, Inc. and Monsters University. Monstropolis is running on safe, clean laugh power. But even now, it still needs more laughs to provide for the needs of the monster world. To that end, Mike Wazowski suggested the idea of opening a Monstropolis comedy club to humans via a Door to Tomorrowland. There you go. I'm going to go first. I know I'm wearing the shirt. The Haunted Mansion backstory is the most convoluted, nonsensical, unclear junk ever. Like, in there are good backstories, but the fact that there's so many and people all tell different ones makes me not care. I don't care anymore. I just like the ride. I like the ghosts. I like the music. I don't even care about these backstories anymore. I think the Laffler is a cute premise of them opening a comedy club. Yeah. Say what you want about the attraction. I think the backstory is really cute and thoughtful. Nick?
Yep. Laughs over frights. Let's go with the Laffler.
Pete?
Monsters Inc. Laffler, and I actually do believe it is a very cool backstory. I mean, it's fun, it's easy to understand, but Monsters Inc. Laffler, I think I totally agree.
Eric?
Like Tom said, Haunted Mansion is one of my favorite attractions. I got to separate the backstory from the attraction. It is all over the place. There are a million different backstories, even within the ride, I think. So
there's even like the Walt Disney backstory, right? That he opened a retirement home for ghosts.
Right, it was a retirement home for ghosts. Now there's this bride. It might be the lady on a tombstone, Constance Hatchaway.
Now, so who knows?
Captain Culpepper Klein, Eddie Murphy. It's just all over the place. And so I do think the Monsters, Inc. Laugh Floor is a clever, cute, simple backstory. It's not going to go far, but I think it's going to edge out the convoluted Haunted Mansion backstory that some of them are intriguing, but I think it needs to be unified somehow.
What, you pick Laugh Floor?
Yep.
Wow, that's four for Laugh Floor. Marcy?
Yeah, there's just too much going on with the Haunted Mansion, so I'm going to do Laugh Floor.
Wow. David?
Yeah, I'm sticking with Coherence.
Wow. Spencer, is it a sweep?
Yeah, it's a sweep. I don't care
about Mansion's backstory. 35-0 for the Laugh Floor.
All right.
That's crazy. What's the next matchup? Ooh, Raging Spirits. A group of explorers were wandering around the jungle when one day they stumbled upon a nearly 5,000-year-old site. One with idols, a large temple, and two altars, one with fire and one of water. After excavation, the explorers decided to make the fire and water statues face each other. This was a mistake. The defilement of the temple angered the two gods and restarted an ancient battle between fire and water. And there you have Raging Spirits versus Mystic Manor. Oh, boy. Mystic Manor is the mansion of Lord Henry Mystic, built in an uncharted tropical wilderness in New Guinea, plagued with supernatural events. The mansion was built out of Henry's love for the unusual happenings and officially dubbed the area Mystic Point. Mystic Manor is where many of his findings, as well as some other members of the Society of Explorers and Adventurers, have found, things they found are displayed. As of recent events, Henry has brought in a new exhibit, a mysterious Balinese music box that has been rumored that its music brings inanimate objects to life. Guests are invited to tour Mystic Manor through one of Henry's vehicles of his own invention, a Mystic Magneto chassis, or a carriage, excuse me. And, of course, also next door, he has a place for you to dine, the Explorers Club, where he would meet with all his adventurer friends and share a meal amongst some of his other relics. These are two really, really good ones. So, Spencer, I'm going to put you, they're two Asia attractions, so what are you picking?
These are both in Animal Kingdom.
Oh, Henry Mystic's a sea member, by the way.
I've always found it hard to care about Raging Spirits because the ride is kind of lame. But I've also never been to Mystic Manor, so this is, but I probably just have to go with Mystic Manor, honestly.
David?
Yeah, I'm going with Mystic Manor, and here's my problem with Raging Spirits, is I expect some logic to the motivation in the backstory. In this one, the explorers who did the excavation, for some apparent reason that's entirely unclear, decide to make the statues face each other, and that's what angers the gods. I don't get the logic there. Mystic Manor.
Marcy.
Yeah, I haven't been to either of these attractions, but Mystic Manor just looks really, really cool. So that, and the backstory is really cool.
Okay. Pete?
Mystic Manor, this is, to me, is kind of an easy one. Dave makes a good point. Like, you turn some statues and they were like, oh, now we're going to start fighting again. Like, it was easier when I was facing, when I was cheating stage left. I don't, Mystic Manor sounds incredible, looks incredible. Everyone talks about it. I haven't been on it, but even watching ride-throughs, I, like, get it. It's super cool.
Eric?
Yeah, Raging Spirits looks and sounds like something from Busch Gardens.
You're right.
Yeah, and Mystic Manor, I mean, obviously, he's a sea member. There's a lot of artifacts and all this cool sea stuff that I like. A little depth of story there. Obviously, it has a
so
culture.
There's so much more backstory we can't even talk about.
Yeah, but it has like a culture all its own, right? It has its own like cult of personality. So Mystic Manor.
Nick?
Really? You picked Port Orleans to go on for a half an hour about and not Mystic Manor?
Yeah, right. I guess
Mystic Manor.
That's fair. Yeah, it's a sweep for Mystic Manor. I'll talk about Mystic later when we have time. Mystic Manor blowout. What's up next? Oh boy, Mysterious Island at Tokyo Disney Sea. Another one of my favorites. I can actually throw this sheet away. That sheet's done. That should make it easier to find stuff now, right? He said as he continued to just search for things. Oh, where's Mysterious Island here? I'll start giving you the gist of it. Obviously, Mysterious Island, if you've ever seen 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea or read the book, you know, obviously it is the home of Captain Nemo. It was his secret base, right? And in contrast, well, I'll read it to you here. Recreation of the fictitious one in Jules Verne's novel, The Mysterious Island, which serves as Captain Nemo's lair. It's also known as Volcania, as featured in the Disney movie 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. When guests enter the area, they discover Nemo's secret base, complete with a harbor for the Nautilus, as well as a lab inside the volcano known as Mount Prometheus. Nemo is exploring the depths of the sea and of the earth, which allows guests to experience two of Verne's most famous adventures, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, Journey to the Center of the Earth. Guests have been invited on a tour in-universe where Captain Nemo actually wanted to share his discoveries. This is different from the film where he didn't want to share his discoveries. And the idea here is they are inviting you on these joy excursions, one in these tiny submarine vehicles he's built. And you don't ride in the Nautilus on the ride. You ride in the tiny vehicle, which if you look on the left hanging from that structure over there, there's one there. And then the same with the vehicles in Journey to the Center of the Earth. You're being invited to take a pleasure ride through these caves. Obviously, in both, something goes horribly wrong. What is it up against? Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout. Based in the Collector's Fortress, where his collection is, the T'Van collection, as seen in the film Guardians of the Galaxy, the collector, Tenelier T'Van, is showing off his latest acquisitions, the Guardians of the Galaxy, in customized display cases. However, Rocket has secretly escaped his case and asked guests to help, but his hands don't scan, and that's where you come in. He's got to use your hands to scan to open up different doors in different places, and you're an active participant in the story and him saving the Guardians of the Galaxy. Obviously, there's a lot more to both of these, but yeah. Spencer.
I gotta go with Mysterious Island.
Yeah, you do. David, no explanation needed.
Yeah, I'm not sure there is any explanation needed. Mysterious Island is just the way Jules Verne should have been. If they'd done that in Paris, it would have been awesome.
Yeah. Marcy?
I'm also going to go with Mysterious Island. It's hard to argue a land versus an attraction, even though Mission Breakout could have gone very wrong for an overlay, but they did a really good job with it.
Nick?
Yeah, it's a shame. Mission Breakout, I feel, should go further than this, but I can't vote for it over Mysterious Island.
Pete?
I disagree. I mean, it's a land. I mean, it's cool. And yes, the theming is great. It looks beautiful. We're not here to talk about theming and how it looks. It's backstory. And I think how they put the Mission Breakout backstory together to make it work on the old Tower of Terror is genius.
Where are you, though?
You are entering the collector's building, whatever.
Where? Where are you?
Doesn't he live in nowhere?
I'm pretty sure, correct me if I'm wrong, Anaheim.
But it's, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, Avengers Campus takes place in California. We're supposed to believe the collection's in California? Like, this guy just put the collection
Avengers
on Earth?
Campus isn't there yet. It's going there, but essentially...
But it's still where it is.
It's still
the rock. Do you think it makes more sense in Hollywood land?
You're telling me that all these other backstories, because they don't have places?
The backstory, I like the backstory Mission Breakout, but they don't explain why you're there, and I don't know how in Avengers Campus it makes sense that it's there. It's an Avengers, like, base. The Avengers, like, told Tanner Tavon, yeah, lock up our friends in your warehouse and build it on our property.
I disagree. I think in a lot of backstories they don't tell you how or where or how you got there. There's time travel involved.
I think the best backstories do tell you why you're there.
That's a fair point. I think it's easier to vote because it's such a beautiful land and it's well themed. Yeah. I just think the backstory. How do you pull off this ride without the backstory? And again, I think
it's not a bad backstory. The problem all comes from where the ride was, and then you overlaid a ride. But it's great. It's a great attraction. And it's a great story, but I think the problem with the backstory is it's just
is that it has holes for you, which is fine.
Yeah,
and I get that. This is not something I'm super passionate about. This is a super hard matchup. I just believe that I think they knocked the backstory for this right out of the park, maybe better than any other overlay that I've seen done.
Okay, Eric.
Jules Verne is like one of the greatest storytellers in the history of the world.
So is Stan Lee, though.
And you, yeah. Okay, so is Stan Lee. Fair enough. And I think the one is an entire land that is built around these stories. The other is come in and they did an admirable job of skillfully creating a story for a ride system that wasn't part of this story originally. Yeah. So that's admirable. I think it's cool. But, I mean, Mysterious Island, it has to be Mysterious Island.
Yep, Mysterious Island. 30-5. All right, what's the next matchup? We have more Marvel, I think. Star Wars Galaxy's Edge. Oh, boy. Do you not have the thing it's up against?
Star Wars versus Marvel here.
It is Star Wars versus Marvel. Whenever I find it, it'll happen. Someday. Star Wars Galaxy's Edge. The team at Imagineering and Lucasfilm decided to set the lands on a new planet located within the outer rim of the unknown regions. Described as a remote frontier outpost, the planet Batu has not previously appeared in other media, although it's existed within canon for thousands and thousands of years. This used to be a vibrant trading port back in the old sub-light speed days, but now with the advent of hyperspace, its prominence has kind of fallen and faded a little bit, which has made it a great spot for those who didn't want to be on that kind of mainstream path. This is Radiator Springs. The smugglers, the bounty hunters, the rogue adventurers looking to crew up, the people who didn't want to be found, basically all the interesting people are here on the edge of the galaxy. And it's up against the Iron Man Experience and Ant-Man and the Wasp Nano Battle. These are interconnected. Arriving visitors are at the Stark Expo at Hong Kong Disneyland, where they can learn the history of Howard Stark, the founder of Stark Industries, before meeting current president Tony Stark, who's introducing a new invention known as the Iron Wing. At the expo, guests can experience the history of Stark Industries through inventions by Howard Stark and into the present day, where Tony is inspiring his team of scientists and engineers to make our lives better, more convenient, and safer through technology. At the back of the area, guests can enter the simulator attraction. The ride begins when Jarvis attempts to fly out of the park to see Stark Tower in Hong Kong. That's the whole idea. But at that point, Hydra is using giant robots to try and steal the arc reactor on the Hong Kong Stark Tower. Meanwhile, at Ant-Man and the Wasp Nano Battle, guests enter the newly opened Shield Science and Technology Pavilion at the Stark Expo, where they are supposed to discover technological innovations showcased by Shield. In the lobby, guests discover through screens featuring Leslie Lamb, Ant-Man, the Wasp, and Iron Man that the pavilion is under attack by Arnim Zola. This is the same attack that's happening in the other attraction. And the army of swarm bots. Their goal is to steal the data core, precious data stored by Shield in the pavilion. Star Wars. Nick, Star Wars versus Marvel.
No.
What do you like?
I mean, the Stark and Ant-Man thing sound like a cool story, but to be able to step in a real breathing Star Wars story is the dream, and that's I'd have to go with that. I'm gonna put aside any broken promises from what was gonna be in that land, but and just go with the story, and definitely Galaxy's Edge.
Pete,
I agree with Nick. As I think it's super cool to that it's something you just identified. You know where you are, why you're there. It's a great backstory that you're at the Stark Expo, and it's really cool that they added on a new wing, and then it's with the whole nanotechnology, and you get to experience that as well. It's just a shame that it's up against Galaxy's Edge. I think they do a great job of, and now granted, I know people were upset that it wasn't a specific place that already was in this story, like a Tatooine or something like that, but I think they had to come up with a story that made it work for what the parks were, and to be able to become a part of that story is very neat, and to walk among everything else. And again, I'm not... They explain why everything is there, which is hard. Like, hey, why is the Millennium Falcon just parked right here? So you need a story to pull all that together. I think Star Wars Galaxy's Edge does that well.
Eric?
I'm going to try to evaluate Galaxy's Edge as if I didn't know that there were better backstories that existed and better backdrops for this land,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Just as something that can stand on its own. And I'm pretty critical of it because I think... Here we are. It's a remote frontier outpost. Nobody goes there, you know, except like every major character. And like Kylo Ren just happens to be walking around. And you got, you know, all these major...
Darth Vader and Amidala came here at some point.
Yeah, and yeah. You got Chewie walking around and Rey and Vi and all these people. The Millennium Falcon's around the corner. And the tension is so thick you could cut it with a knife and all this...
Meanwhile, this other lady's just trying to sell plush.
Yeah.
Poor Toydarian toy maker. People are shooting at each other. She's like, plush, Watto!
So I realize, though, they have to insert IP into something, even, but the story doesn't match what they're doing. I don't know anything about this Stark thing. I don't know. I half fell asleep while you're reading it. So I begrudgingly have to vote for Galaxy's Edge.
Lady Stark?
Spencer?
Sorry, hard to find the mute button. you know, Galaxy's Edge broke a lot of promises, I'm told. I've never been. But it still feels somewhat more... It feels like somewhat more effort was put into it than Stark Expo. It just feels like with the Iron Man experience, it's just another Marvel movie. You know, you can come up with those easily. I gotta vote for Galaxy's Edge.
David?
Yeah, I'm with Eric on this. I'm not impressed with either one of these. I'm gonna go with Galaxy's Edge, but you know, I have the same qualms that he does, so I'm not gonna repeat them.
Marcy?
Yeah, I really actually don't like the backstory to Galaxy's Edge. I don't think it makes sense, and it's just annoying. But at the same time, like, I haven't seen or, you know, been to the Marvel one, and it doesn't seem like it's super in-depth. So I'm going to have to go with Galaxy's Edge, but, you know.
Yeah, I'm going to go with Galaxy's Edge. We'll get to talk about it more in a later round. It's a blowout. All right, put up the number. So you can call in now. We're going to take a commercial break. During the commercial break, if you got to vote for any of these that just happened, the number is 8327-WDWNT7. That's 8327-WDWNT7. We'll be back with, oh boy, more of this after this.
The line for Savvy's Workshop custom lightsaber experience is already closed for the day, and you can't even grab a free spork from Docking Bay 7 anymore? What are you going to do with your day in Galaxy's Edge? Well, why not skip the hustle and bustle of Batuu and come into Tom's Spork Shop custom spork building experience? We're located conveniently in the nearby Red Rose Tavern restrooms in Fantasyland, but if the evil First Order or Disney management comes by, remember, we're just going to the bathroom, not illegally running a spork building business in a theme park. It's all part of the story and theme of our immersive experience. With the help of my assistants I call the cronies, each guest gets their own private stall to build one of four types of custom sporks. Peace and justice. Power and control. Elemental nature. and protection and defense. We have over 500 pieces and three colors of Sharpie to choose from, so no two sporks are ever the same. And at the low cost of $19.99 a spork, you can afford to make more than one. Cast member annual pass holder discounts do not apply. So hop on a land speeder and zoom on down to Tom's Spork Shop in the Red Rose Tavern restrooms in Fantasyland at Disneyland Park. No reservations necessary. And may the sporks be with you.
The 20 years of adventure in California merchandise coming from the carousel of products, like this limited edition of 200 collectible button, which wishes the park a happy birthday. Or you can write your own name on there. Do whatever you like, only $4. We also have t-shirts because I hate wearing this thing. It's very hot in it under these lights. But you could be comfortable in these t-shirts. Yes, this one has a roadmap. It's upside down, but when you turn it this way, it has a roadmap of California on it with all your favorite landmarks from the past and the present, maybe even things you really hated, but it's kind of fun that they're here. And all of our tees have the Carousel of Products logo. This limited edition shirt, $20. Like all of our t-shirts, including this one, which has the Sun Wheel insignia on it with all these great landmarks from the park, as well as this beautiful and, well, sometimes bad skyline of things past and present from California. Again, only $20 from the Carousel of Products.
And just added to the collection is a fancy new face mask for just $9 and this limited edition of 200 pin that's only $8. Isn't that just the bee's orange? I mean, knees, whatever. Just head to carouselofproducts.com.
Welcome back to WDW News Tonight. We are live on YouTube. Please hit that like button if you're still awake. Please subscribe if you haven't. And now's a good time to get yourself a cup of coffee. Start slapping yourself in the face. Whatever you got to do. That's what we just did. Nick and I just stood like this, and we just started slapping each other during the commercial
break.
Fun
to watch.
What's coming up then?
For part of the day.
What's coming up on the show the next few weeks?
You too.
Oh, boy. I've lost my pen. All right. On March 25th, we will conclude our March Madness backstories. That's just when this episode will end. We'll just be running until then.
Talk until then.
Yeah. On April 1st, it is our April Fool's show. It's a very special show.
Mostly just Pete, right?
We'll have the debut of a new segment, the top seven funniest attractions, and more that week. On April 8th, we have a all-food, kind of a food-themed episode, Chicken Nugget Death Match.
Yes.
On April 8th, and the DFB Cupcake Game. Meanwhile, on April 15th, the old feelings discussion, and then April 22nd is our last show of the season, our last show for a couple months,
no,
in fact.
Did we decide that?
Disneyland reopens on April 30th, so we can't do a show on the 29th.
Oh. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So, as of now, April 22nd is our last show. If, for some reason, things change, we'll see in the next couple weeks. We may have an April 29th show, but that'll be the last show in
breaking
this building. In this building, yeah. Not that we have a new place, but it's definitely the last one we're doing in this building. Nick, who brings us to show every week?
WDW News Tonight is brought to you by The Vacationaire, the engineers of your next magical vacation. Sit back and let their team of vacation planning experts craft your family's next magical Disney trip. The best part is their services are absolutely free. Visit WDWNT.travel for details. The Vacationaire, the official travel agency of WDWNT.
Thank you, Nick. All right. Let's get back to the tournament.
Do it. Oh. Nice job. Gets me in the mood.
We're just always surprised when things play when they're supposed to.
I know, right?
Do we have any score updates from the last round?
Good call. Let me check.
There it is!
There it is, and guess what? We have it overturned!
Good, it was played for the right, it was played correctly then.
Space Mountain Terra de la Luna got three calls to put it over Sid to Chumahungas. Yeah!
No! Hungus? He's nuts!
Was that an Italian dish versus an Asian dish?
Yo.
There you go.
Space Cannon!
No.
What did you guys do? He's dead! What did you do? Is that it?
Yes.
Okay. All right, let's start the next round. Time for me to rifle through some sheets. Let's do it. What's up? Oh, boy. All right, here we go. Time for Thunder Mesa, Frontierland at Disneyland Paris. Henry Ravenswood, born 1795, was a Western settler who struck gold in Big Thunder Mountain and founded Big Thunder Mining Company, thus creating the city of Thunder Mesa. Ravenswood became rich and built himself a Victorian manor. This is for you, Eric. You love these. He built himself a Victorian manor high on Boot Hill, overlooking the mountain where he raised his family, his wife Martha and daughter Melanie Ravenswood, born 1842. Big Thunder Mountain was thought by the local Native Americans to be home of the Thunderbird, a powerful spirit. According to the legend, its wrath would fall on any who disturbed the mountain. However, Ravenswood would not believe the stories. Time went by, and the gold in Big Thunder began to run out, making miners dig deeper. Melanie grew from a girl into a beautiful young woman who caught the eye of many would-be suitor. Four men would court Melanie, but each met some unfortunate fate not long after their respective intentions of marrying her were known. Just when Melanie thought herself doomed to a lonely life, she finally became engaged to a train engineer who planned to take her far away from Thunder Mesa, much to the dismay of Henry. Henry did everything he could to stop the wedding, but his attempts were put to an abrupt end when a terrible earthquake struck in 1860 and killed he and Martha. It seemed the Thunderbird had been awakened, and the family was never heard from again. After several years, the story of what really happened came out from underneath the rubble. On Melanie's wedding day, shortly thereafter, a mysterious phantom unknown to anyone appeared at the manor. While Melanie was preparing in her room, the phantom lured her suitor up to the attic where he hung him by the neck from the rafters. Oof. In the ballroom, the bride sat alone. Hours went by with no sign of the groom. Guests slowly filed away, leaving Melanie alone in the house with the staff of maids and butlers. Someday, she told herself, he will come. And so, having never taken off her wedding dress or dropped her bouquet, in preparation for her loved one's return, she wandered the house aimlessly, singing melancholy songs of lost love. The phantom still lurks in the house, laughing at her human devotion to her intended husband. One after one, he invited his dead, demonic friends from the afterlife to fill the house in an eternal party. The shape of the house was slowly transformed by evil forces. Years passed, inside and outside the manor decayed. Outside, the once beautiful grounds fell to ruins. The gilded staircase and structure were dotted with mold and trees, and every plant on the grounds died. As if sensing the evil inherent in the house, nothing living ever trod there. Inside, dust and cobwebs covered every single inch.
Wholesome Disney family fun right here.
Yeah, right?
More Disney, more family.
The disheartened staff not caring for it was rumored that Melanie had lost her mind. She wandered the house for years and years, singing softly to her groom, while all around her demons and ghosts danced. Everywhere she went, she was reminded of the wedding. The Phantom's eternal laughter still carried through the walls of the house. Melanie even kept her hopes, waiting for her love's return, and never figured out why he had left. The earthquake that killed her parents cut a huge gouge in the west half of the property and in the crumbling ghost town of Old Thunder Mesa. The deserted buildings were rumored to be called Phantom Canyon, the dark supernatural version of the town, and anyone who entered the ghastly old town at night never came back. Today, no one knows if Melanie Ravenswood is still alive in that old house on the hill. If she is, she's well over 100. Some nights, when the moon is full and the sky is clear of clouds, you can still hear the lonely mourning of the bride, the maniacal laughter of the phantom, and the faint tinkle of glass and chatter of party guests. Whether she's alive or not, what is well known is that poor Melanie never really left the crumbling mansion. She waits for her groom until Judgment Day. I don't know how you beat that. What's it up against? Oh boy!
It's amazing.
Oh, this is the most.
Gonna be closer than we thought.
The absolute biggest juxtaposition in the history of all of our March Madness tournaments.
This like, is far the way and away. A 1 and a 16 should be, though.
Yeah. You arrive in Hollywood. You are given an agent, and a limo tours you through the town as you see other celebrities. In the end, you become the next big star.
Avec Aerosmith.
That's it.
Sounds like the Scrooge McDuck story.
Let's make it quick. Nick.
Phantom Manor.
Yep, I vote Phantom. Pete.
Phantom.
Eric.
You got to go for a riches to corpse story. I go with Phantom Manor.
Spencer.
Well, I don't know. This is tough. And I could spend the next 10 minutes going on and on about this story.
Hello, cute baby.
Phantom Manor.
Hello,
cute
Snoopy.
Snoopy! Oh, look at the big Snoopy!
It's a huge Snoopy.
All right. Marcy? I don't know if we got his answer. I don't care. Marcy?
I can't vote for death, so I'm going with limo.
Wow.
What?
You realize half these backstories about death.
You're not really.
There's murder. There's like, I don't know.
She doesn't want that in her Disney.
Someone hasn't seen Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. And David.
Oh, that's a good movie.
I can't vote for death. Phantom Manor.
Thank you. Jeez. I can't believe that's not a blowout. Unbelievable. All right, what's next?
You know, Marcy makes a good point.
The Tropical Hideaway. I'm going to find this thing, this Tropical Hideaway. It's very hidden, of course. I don't know. You get Dole Whips here. I'll find it. No, it's separated by a page. That's where I can't find it.
Jeez, started chilling objects.
Oh, nope. This is great. Next week, I'm going to put these in order. Nope.
The good news is a beautiful image on the screen.
Living on the shores of Adventureland's rivers and adjacent to the Enchanted Tiki Room, Tropical Hideaway is a rest stop for Adventureland locals and explorers alike, including members of the Society of Explorers and Adventurers that started a tradition of displaying paddles from various expeditions. In the relaxing setting of an exotic marketplace, guests can enjoy the views of the passing jungle crews, meet Rosita, the missing member of the Enchanted Tiki Room showgirl Birds, who has set off on her own to start a solo career, and also see the homes of all the tiki birds that are just above the Tropical Hideaway. Hmm. And it's up against the Tree of Life. This is a cute story. Once upon a time, no vegetation would grow on Discovery Island. There were no trees, no shrubs, no flowers, nothing. It was a barren piece of land. And then one day a tiny ant planted a seed and he made a wish. He asked for a tree to grow, a tree large enough to provide shelter for all the animals. Magically, the ant's wish came true and a tree began to grow. And it kept growing until there was room beneath its limb for all of the animals from A to Z. And as the tree continued to reach for the heavens, the images of the animals that took shelter beneath its shade appeared on its trunks, roots, and branches. Mr. Dak,
and
Pete,
the ant
ahead.
Was a C member.
I was going to say.
He was a rich ant.
Ant have.
A rich ant.
This is, this, for me, it's Tree Life. Yeah, I love Dak. I love the story. I think this is a Disney story, especially, you know, if you're not voting death. This is the cutest.
Vote life!
Vote life!
We are pro Tree of Life on this show.
It's a story of hope. Sure. It explains how the images got there. It is a great story. It's a great image. It. I think it should go deeper than most. We'll have it go. You two are both out of control. We keep talking over here. When you two giggle in the corner.
Oh no.
Oh, that's our March tragic shirt, pro tree of life.
It is.
Eric, go ahead.
There it goes.
Tree of life.
A tree.
It's so good.
Tree of life.
Tree of life. Nick.
Yeah, Tree of Life is a cute Disney park story.
You know, I love the Adventureland stories in Tiki Room, but there's so many good adventure stories on this list. And Tropical Hideaway is just kind of the least in depth of all of them. Mm-hmm. I'm pro Tree of Life. Here we go. Marcy.
Oh, boy.
See, this is a feel-good story.
Oh, boy.
This is going up against adversity. This is about inclusion. This is about all that stuff. So let's do Tree of Life.
Wow. David?
Now I'm tempted to vote against Tree of Life for that. I'll stick with it.
Spencer.
Well, to be fair, we're also pro choosing a winner of this tournament, right? So,
Spencer.
You know, David took my gimmick of voting against Marcy out of spite, but I still have to go with the Tree of Life.
Wow. There you go, Tree of Life. It's a blowout. It's just too cute. What's next? That's not. That's the wrong Star Tours. Wrong Star Tours? What are you doing here? Don't worry, it's going to take me several moments to find the sheet. Oh, boy. Star Tours, also known as Star Tours Travel Agency or Star Tours Space Lines, was an interstellar travel agency which gave tours to prominent planets and moons in the galaxy. The company existed as far back as the time of the Clone Wars, but was forced to file for bankruptcy in the year 4 ABY after a series of dramatic... That's after the Battle of Yavin, by the way. That's still the wrong Star Tours. After a series of dramatic accidents, that's new Star Tours. That's the Star Speeder 1000. That's not the 3000. You're fired.
But to be honest, what a great reason to tell your I don't care. Employer you were fired.
It's too late. It's too late. Nick, did I say both of them? No. What's the other one?
Go with the other one.
What's the other one?
GM Test Track.
GM Test Track. Good, you picked the right one. Guests would arrive at a GM test facility and are able to ride in an actual test vehicle to see how GM test facilities all over the world test automotives, how they test the various pieces and functions of a car. Nick.
Yeah, I mean, space with robots and a tour through space, yes, Star Tours.
I'm also going with... I think this was the greatest idea. I think the most original idea that someone sat there was like, no, we're not gonna let you fly an X-Wing. Mm-hmm. We're gonna make up a fake travel... a fake travel agency. You're gonna fly in this, like, tour liner. I think it's the most original and thoughtful story. I love it. Eric?
Did George Lucas say he cared about this one?
I think he did.
He did.
Yeah, the
I don't know. I can see where it's disappointing, though, because it's like Fast and Furious Supercharged before there's Fast and Furious Supercharged. Like, I'm going to fly an X-Wing. And they're like, nope, you're flying an airliner.
I think you're wrong. Star Tours is amazing.
But it's better than Test Track. So, Star Tours.
Pete?
Yeah, this imagination, hey, this is the way you're going to travel through space, or have you want to go to a factory? So, Star Tours.
Marcy?
Yeah, I like the Star Tours backstory, even though I don't love the ride.
Yeah. David?
Easy, Star Tours.
Spencer?
This is the original, like, 1999 Test Track.
98, yeah.
Then I'm going with Test Track.
Okay.
It's like that Simpsons episode where they went on a field trip to the box factory.
What's the Simpsons?
What's the Simpsons, though? What you just said? What's the next matchup? Olivia's at Old Key West, where I don't go eat anymore because the manager's mean. That's the backstory. I have a mean backstory of the manager.
You need six forms. I need to use your tables one.
Yeah. I can't even find it. I know that's going to shock everybody because I've been so good at finding these.
She couldn't afford to open a restaurant. She fed people at her house.
Oh, I thought she was
yeah,
super
I mean, you
rich.
Pretty much, you and pretty much
yeah, it's a poor person, finally.
Olivia Farnsworth lived in a small cottage along Turtle Crawl upwind of the Strip. She loved cooking, did not have the money to open a restaurant of her own. She was very friendly and very proud of her cooking. Almost daily, she'd invite curious passers-by who smelled her cooking to come into her dining room and pull up a chair to enjoy what she had prepared. Soon, these visits became more and more frequent, both for the locals and for visiting out-of-towners. Olivia quickly ran out of room and everything else. People began bringing their own tables and chairs and even silverware, then left them there for their next visit. That's why the silverware and the chairs in the restaurant are mismatched, they used to be, and add to a homey, family-style atmosphere. This was not a restaurant that was built, but it was Olivia's small cottage home, which was transformed into a restaurant by necessity and has been operating successfully for quite some time. And Olivia's is up against... Oh, man. Poor Olivia's. Poor Olivia's is up against Dino-Rama and Dino-Land. Dino-Land USA is set in a place called Diggs County, which is located somewhere in the western United States. Back in the 40s, someone found interesting bones in Diggs County, which led to a boom in visitors. From scientists and grad students to others interested, a lot of traffic made its way to Diggs County in search of whatever dinosaur discoveries were awaiting. As they continue to find bigger and better dinosaur bones, the researchers built the Dino Institute to show off their discoveries to travelers from near and far. Diggs County locals and husband and wife team Chester and Hester took note of the influx of visitors in the area and decided to turn their longtime gas station into a general store. With this increase in Diggs County population, there was a lot of opportunity for the couple to make some extra cash. Their shop, named Chester and Hester's Dinosaur Treasures, is home to all sorts of knickknacks. From toys and books to tacky gift shop finds, the shop really takes on the dinosaur-inspired theme, featuring dino puns and all. As the Dino Institute continued to grow in worldwide popularity, Chester and Hester are ready to cash in even more. So right across the street from their shop, they opened up Chester and Hester's Dino-Rama in the parking lot. The area includes carnival-esque attractions like a spinner ride and a wacky roller coaster. There's also dinosaur-themed midway games, and while most assume this area was just thrown together in comparison to other aspects of the park, but with the knowledge of its backstory, it makes perfect sense as to why the area is so kitschy. Olivia's versus... Dino-Rama, Pete.
Even though Dino-Rama is trash, the backstory is fantastic and actually ties this land together. So since we were doing backstories, Dino-Land all the way.
Eric.
I like to think that all the like senior Imagineers came up with the Maharaja Jungle Trek story and the Tree of Life story. And then they're like, well, there's one part of the park. We don't have budget for anything else. We got a bunch of junk. And let's make the intern come up with a story. And then the intern hit it out of the park. I think the story... does a good job of justifying how crappy that part of the park is. So I go with Dino-Rama.
Well, let's be clear. Dino-Rama is crappy, right? Because I don't think the rest of Dino-Land is crappy.
Oh, no. That's why I said Dino-Rama.
What about Dino-Rama?
Yeah. But no, this is both. This is Chester and Hester and Dino-Land. It's
one story. But you're talking about
one story.
The physical space, not the story. The story is wonderful for both.
Yeah. But it's one story.
Yeah, but Dino-Rama is an actual physical space. It's trash. And the rest of the land
Correct.
Is really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Nick?
Not joking here. Chester and Hester's is like one of my favorite spots in all of Walt Disney World. I love that shop. I love exploring the little nooks and crannies and things on the wall, looking up, seeing everything. It just reminds me of road trips I'd take with my family. We'd stop at like these roadside places along the way between Connecticut and Florida.
It's like
it's crazy.
Cars Land before Cars Land.
Yeah. So definitely Dino Land. Not even a question.
Yeah, I love Olivia's, but this is gonna go. This is like
also,
final.
Also, the backstory
four.
For Olivia's doesn't match the restaurant anymore, so it kind of takes points away from me. The chairs don't mismatch anymore.
But we have other things that are old, original, or
supposed to be.
Yeah.
It's true, David.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've already said it. Dino-Rama is the better story. I just want to give, you know, praise to the Olivia's Cafe backstory. That's a really unique idea for a restaurant.
Yeah.
And, you know, coming to it from that direction, that was a good idea, but it doesn't beat Dino-Rama and Dino USA.
Marcy?
Well, I know everybody's obviously voting for Dinorama, but I need to give Olivia's a little bit of love just because I hadn't heard that backstory before, and it's just such a cute story. And, you know, when the stuff was mismatched and everything, and it's because people would bring their things in, and it was, you know, her home, and then it turned into, I really, really like that. I think that it's really, really cute and actually could be, like, based in reality, whereas, you know, Dinorama's out there.
Spencer?
What's Olivia's Dinorama? Dinorama, I think someone, I can't remember who said it earlier, but I really like that despite the fact that it feels cheap compared to the rest of the park, it feels justified for how cheap it is. It's really, it feels like an afterthought, but also it somehow fits into the park, and I can appreciate that.
All right, next matchup. Obviously, Dinoland wins. Oh, boy. Typhoon Lagoon. Home of the Typhoon Legume, a large anthropomorphic peanut who founded Typhoon Lagoon.
Backstory has like a guy who lost his glasses in the pool and is spending the rest of his life trying to find them.
The Typhoon Legume. A furious storm once roared across the sea, catching ships in its path, helpless to flee. Instead of a certain and watery doom, the wind swept them here to Typhoon Lagoon. That same fictitious storm from 1955, known as Hurricane Connie, inflicted near total destruction on the nearby island belonging to the descendants of Meriwether Adam Pleasure as well. The fabled typhoon drastically changed the small Placid Palms resort village, and to make matters worse, a resulting earthquake and volcanic eruption left the community almost in ruins. Surfboards, fishing gear, boats, and other nautical items were flung wildly throughout the area. Trees toppled not only onto some of the buildings, but into them as well. One old ship tanker was completely overturned, and today guests could walk into it. used to be a thing. Many species of marine life, not necessarily native to the area, were deposited in the surrounding waters by the wind and water. Even a pair of jaws from the fictional Sharkish Gigantus washed up on the beach. The plucky inhabitants used their ill fortune to transform Placid Palms Resort into the Leaning Palms Resort, referencing the fact that some of the remaining palm trees were almost completely uprooted. The local residents resourcefully rebuilt the town as best they could with the flotsam and jetsam of found objects. The much-beloved Walt Disney Imagineer Randy Bright summarized the effect back in the 1980s. Upon entering Typhoon Lagoon, guests find themselves... I don't know where they find themselves, on another sheet of paper. It's what always happens with this. Guests find themselves...
What?
If you go to Typhoon Lagoon, you'll find
out where they find themselves. That's the story.
What's they find the, themselves on this island.
What's
find
the question next?
Yeah.
Come find
a Typhoon Lagoon.
Ooh, Satuli Canteen in Pandora, the World of Avatar. Satuli Canteen.
Guests find themselves eating the best quick service on property.
It was once the mess hall for the Resources Development Administration base and is now owned and operated by Alpha Centauri Expeditions. The canteen features Navi cultural items in an attempt to make it feel more homey than it was as a basically an army mess hall. They've covered it in Pandoran art artifacts. There's photos showing the relationship between the Navi and humans in this point in time much further away from the films. Where peace has been reached between the two, and that's kind of the theme, right? The backstory is the theme. It's you know, the culture reclaiming the land that was taken from them and it being used to teach people about the culture. There you go. Nick, what do you like?
I love the Satuli Canteen, but it does not deserve a vote here in the first round. It's a great story. It's a nice story. But, I mean, Typhoon Lagoon is I think... when Disney built those water parks, they really put some thought into them and made them real story-driven parks and not just places to go down a water slide. So it has to be Typhoon Lagoon.
Pete?
Yeah, Nick kind of hit the nail on the head. I was going to say, even though Satuli is great, and even, again, I think it's the best food, and I think it's I love hanging out there. There's so many, I love so many things about Satuli, but the backstory is just, hey, this is an old cafeteria. We try to make it pretty and cool for current times. Typhoon Lagoon backstory is an actual backstory. It's fun. It has it's got a fun little history. Yeah, easy. Typhoon Lagoon.
Eric?
Typhoon Lagoon.
Spencer.
Typhoon Lagoon, yeah.
David?
I love that they tied Typhoon Lagoon's story into the Pleasure Island story and the same event that caused them, so that's a great thought. I like that one.
Marcy?
Typhoon Lagoon.
Yep, it's a sweep for Typhoon Lagoon. Yeah. And the Typhoon Legume, of course. Next match. Disney Springs. That's the worst image. Disney Springs. Oh, boy. Disney Springs. I got to find this thing now. Don't worry. It's a long one, everybody. Florida has one of the largest concentrations of freshwater springs on Earth, with more than 900 natural springs. Springs have served as locations for Spanish missions, steamboat landings, grist mills, and reservoirs for irrigating crops. A few springs give birth to towns, including Silver Springs in Marion County, Green Cove Spring in Clay County, and De Leon Springs in Volusia County. Both Wakiwa Springs and Rock Springs are roughly an hour from Walt Disney World, and for decades have been popular natural water parks for tourists and local residents. It's the heart of our whole storyline, said Thurin Skies of Walt Disney Imagineering. After studying all kinds of natural kinds of waterways in Florida, we visited quite a few natural springs, really committed to delivering something as authentic as possible. Inspired by the small towns that developed in the early 1900s around these bodies of water, the storyline for Disney Springs is that it also attracts its first settlers more than a century ago, and over the decades, the town continued to expand naturally into four districts: the town center, the landing, the marketplace, and West Side. The original group of settlers discovered a natural spring and a wonderful piece of land near it to settle on in the mid-1800s. They built the town center where the residents lived. They even built a waterside promenade where they could gather to relax after a busy day. As the population grew, the town branched out towards the water with the landing, and then on either side of the town center with the marketplace in the west side. It was an organic expansion, and each area had distinctive architecture to reflect the era of development. In the west side, there are remnants of an elevated train trestle that was supposedly built for the fictional 1950 Spring Centennial Expo that's shown on a poster in Deluxe Burger and at Guest Relations. That expo had hot air balloons and a big distinctive central structure like most World Fair that became Characters in Flight and the Cirque du Soleil building. There are a lot more backstories we can get into. Beyond this, for the sake of time, we won't. What is it up against? Oh, boy. It's up against my son. My son, the Pangalactic Pizza Port. Oh, this is a great backstory, by the way. Pangalactic is a pizza chain that will deliver pizza anywhere in the galaxy. And there's a whole video loop that tells you all about this amazing company. This particular restaurant's built around a giant animated pizza-making machine run by the colorful alien named Tony Solaroni from the Spumoni Galaxy, who has been tasked with running...
It's a robot!
It's an alien. Tasked with running Pangalactic's first Earth franchise location, which is where you are, serving pizza deliveries for the entire solar system. The pizza-making PZ-5000 machine features an entertainment event every few minutes, which may feature a futuristic television commercial for the pizza port or a phone call from Tony's equally alien wife or pizza-making machine going berserk. Spencer, let's get this train a-going for Pangalactic Pizza!
I have sat in Pangalactic Pizza for probably about 2 hours on end sometimes because it's a great place to sit. The food is all right, but I love
the calzones are solid.
Atmosphere. I love the atmosphere. I love Little Green Man Dumplings. The show loop is incredible. I've probably filmed it like 4 times now because I keep getting better cameras.
When are you going to upload that? I want to watch it at home.
You know, I've been taking longer and longer to do it just to watch you suffer.
Wow. Right, I'm only keeping you on camera so I can look at this Snoopy plush. No!
Anyway,
and then a shark comes up and eats him. Pizza. All right, did you pick Pangalactic?
Yes.
Thank you.
On.
David.
I like this matchup just because you're pitting like ultra realism against ultra fantasy. And so it's kind of unique in that way, but I got to go with Pangalactic.
Yeah!
I think that's a great theme for a restaurant.
Marcy!
I voted for pizza before, and I'm going to vote for pizza again.
Mamma mia! Pete!
I think it is harder to come up with a backstory for real-life stuff than it is for fantasy where you can write anything. I've never been to this place. It looks cool, but to me, it's just another pizza place. Disney Springs is very unique. I'm probably be the only one, but Disney Springs.
Very unique. It's like if Sunny Eclipse was actually an interesting show.
I'm just saying, and also there's so many levels. When you cut it off, but like it really is neat how they tie all these neighborhoods together, and it is
the luxury of time
undertaking. I understand you could talk. I'm just saying.
Super dry.
Pete, here's the thing, Pete, is that it's like if Sunny Eclipse was actually an interesting show, it would be at Pangalactic Pizza.
Vera Bradley.
Pangalactic. That show is really good, and Sperry. Sunny Eclipse is boring.
Coca-Cola.
Also, everything Tom is saying is true.
Levi's, Harley Davidson.
I'm waiting until you get to Sugar Boo.
Lego, Sugar Boo.
My vote is Disney Springs.
Eric.
I mean, Spencer used as evidence of Pangalactic Pizza that he spent over 2 hours there. I can assure you, Pete and I have spent a lot more than 2 hours straight at Disney Springs. I don't know if that means it's better.
But that's purely for the story, not because you're getting plastered.
Right. I went to high school near Weeki Wachee Springs.
Me?
Totally
I
different vibe.
Drive Eric home.
But I have to say, I know nothing about Pangalactic Pizza. I really think it's a cool story. So
you
I'll go
learn.
With Pangalactic Pizza, even though I'm sure the pizza is absolutely terrible.
Pick?
I picked Pangalactic Pizza.
You picked Pangalactic?
Yeah.
Oh, Nick?
I'm going to go with the story of Disney Springs. I agree with Pete that...
Such a Floridian.
Look, it's not about the content of... I'm not judging it by the content of the shopping center. I'm judging it by... The story, and I think they developed a great story to do what they wanted to do and to make sense of the surroundings.
Thank you. Well
said. Is she going to hit me with a spork? Come on, I voted for the Virtual Jungle Cruise.
I'm also picking Tony Soleroni and the Pangalactic Pizza Port. Pangalactic wins! What's the next matchup? Oh boy, Wilderness Lodge.
Oh boy.
Time to read more. If I ever find it. Wilderness Lodge backstory begins in the early 1800s. It was primarily in the Silver Creek Star newspaper that served as Wilderness Lodge's hotel guest guide. Though these articles would be phased out in favor of just focusing on guest services. Sure, we'll go with that. Colonel Ezekiel Moreland, a widowed field commander during the War of 1812, set out to survey the Great Northwest in 1822. Though his expedition of 50 men faced disaster from storms, floods, and bison stampedes, and Moreland was left to go with a whole shop. Writing to his daughter, Genevieve, he proclaimed, "I take to the wilderness alone. The good earth will provide me everything I need to survive. I have my gun, I have my courage, and I have my determination. What need I of anything else, especially of cowardly scoundrels who turn ashen in the face of the smallest adversity?"
This sounds like a domestic terrorist. It's a manifesto from a madman. Sorry.
He would not be heard from
again. Which is a good backstory, by the way.
Until 2 years later when he returned to St. Louis with a great bounty of beaver pelts. We're never going to make it through this.
There's my vote.
Make him wealthy. He invited his daughter to a beautiful place he discovered along his journey, Silver Creek Springs. In time, she would establish Wilderness Lodge as an outpost for artists, scientists, and nature enthusiasts in 1848, as well as a wilderness preservation area surrounding the Silver Creek Springs area. The Silver Creek Springs, this is what it used to be called, runs through the resort, starting from a hot spring found towards the back of the lobby. Mm-hmm. From this hot spring, a stream runs under a bridge, down a waterfall, and enters the hotel pool before running into Bay Lake. Additionally, an artificial geyser known as Fire Rock Geyser can be found along Silver Creek. Silver Creek's hot springs made a common stop for different native tribes in the area during winter, with a particular rock formation being a popular place to start campfires. According to legend, during a particularly harsh winter, a hunting party found themselves trapped in the valley by the snows. Forced to keep their campfire going continuously, the hunters wasted much of their firewood and kept trying to find more fuel to feed the fire. After about a week, the fire rock cracked and quaked, with a geyser of water extinguishing the fire and sending their teepee flying away. Believing this to be a bad omen and the Earth's response to their wasteful use of fire, the hunting party fled and never returned to the valley. The geyser has been regularly erupting ever since. Needless to say, this backstory has changed a lot thanks to Copper Creek, but we thought this version was better. So, anyway, what is it up against? You don't have a photo of this? You can find
it. No, I do. This is the photo of it.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know what it is.
This is the XZFR Rockin' Roller Drome, is where we are from Pleasure Island. Jason mentioned this in some detail a couple weeks ago when we were making our own backstories. Jason decided Spaceship Earth had to belong to Adam Merriweather Pleasure for some reason. I don't know why. I can't find it now. Where's XZFR?
Here it is.
According to the legend of the Roller Drome, one of Merriweather Adam Pleasure's passions was the idea of life beyond our planet. In this warehouse, he built an experimental aircraft and beamed messages, including a beacon that used Morse code to spell out welcome, to reach out intelligent life elsewhere. He was an extraterrestrial enthusiast, was Mr. Pleasure. Quite a story. Nick, what do you like?
I'm going to go with the story of Disney's Wilderness Lodge. I think that's a good story. I think it would have been great if they had a crossover with Buford Honeyboo from
That's definitely not the name.
That would have been good.
That's not Wilford Honeyboo, by the way.
The third.
Honeyboo and Company.
Sugarboo.
No, it's the cousin of the wolf.
I'm also going Wilderness Lodge because I think it is the most fantastic backstory. I like Rollerdrome. It's my kind of crazy, but Wilderness Lodge is just so wonderful. Such a great backstory. Love it. Pete?
I mean, a bar, a pleasure island. Wilderness Lodge, better backstory for sure.
Eric?
Okay, so Wilderness Lodge, I just want to point something out, that all these stories are always some colonel or general in the 1800s. Why can't we have like a corporal or a sergeant do something great? It's always some colonel or a general. Yeah, what about Lance Corporal Schmuckatelli? Why couldn't he do anything great? The Rollerdrome, the XZFR, that he kept a spaceship there.
Yeah.
The X thing. And he explored,
the roller rink was around it, right?
Right, it was around it. So it was like a hangar for it. It was not only a hangar, but then it became a broadcast.
Yeah.
And so when you're there, it looks like a radio station. It had an antenna, and it's playing the tunes. Well, guess what? It's also sending messages to aliens. It's pretty cool. But the Wilderness Lodge is...
But then people got drunk and roller skated.
Well, the thing
is
it's already covered. It's already covered under my front runner, the Pleasure Island overall. So I'm gonna say Wilderness Lodge this one time. The guy that had it struck out to the wilderness on the search for beaver wins.
Marcy.
Wilderness Lodge.
David.
Yep, same. Wilderness Lodge.
Spencer.
Wilderness Lodge.
Wilderness Lodge.
XZFR had a better backstory.
The eighth different family is now sitting behind Spencer. That's how long we've been on. Park's going to close soon. All right, what's up next? Miss Adventure Falls.
Oh, they're so sad about this matchup.
Why are you sad about this matchup?
Because Miss Adventure Falls is awesome, but it's going to lose.
Miss Adventure Falls is themed as a shipwreck site of the MS Salty the Fourth. Captain Mary Oceaneer's ship. Cargo and oceanography equipment are scattered around the queue, including crates, Oceaneer's diving bell, or BB-8, frames containing a map of Blustery Bay, which is Typhoon Lagoon's greater area, and a magazine cover featuring Oceaneer and Duncan and some beach chairs for them. Guests are loaded onto treasure rafts and, after a safety spiel from Oceaneer, are taken up a lift hill into the canopy of the tropical forest. Going past the wreckage of her ship, an opening in the hole reveals a cabin full of treasure where Duncan has set up a spyglass to try and find treasure and a lost supply of his crackers. Going past the ship's salvage crane, still containing a chest, the rafts enter, blah, blah, blah. They go through tubes, and you see wreckage and stuff from her collection. She's a sea member. Surprise. That's Misadventure Falls. What is it up against?
Oh, boy.
I know. This is why I'm upset about it. Now you don't want to
Skipper Canteen, operated by Alberta Falls, the granddaughter of the fictitious Dr. Albert Falls. Alberta repurposed the company's tropical headquarters into a restaurant to generate additional revenue from the hungry cruise passengers. The main dining room was the mess hall for the crew. That's where they used to eat. And then there was the Falls family dining room, which is in the back corner, which is obviously the private dining quarters for the family. And then when members of the Society of Explorers and Adventurers came to visit and have meetings, there was a secret dining room for them as well. And this is all, again, connected into this. Well, the story of the Jungle Cruise. Remember, the Jungle Cruise didn't already have a backstory. It didn't really have a real tight backstory. Albert Falls was just kind of created out of a joke. And yet now he's like, the whole backstory is that he owns the company. And this is now basically the story of the Jungle Cruise now. And it's going to be expanded, obviously, with the changes that are coming. Pete, you were unhappy about this matchup. You start us off.
Yeah, I think it's unfair. I think to have such a cool backstory for Miss Adventure Falls, I mean, it's a family raft ride that has a cool backstory. I mean, you don't have backstories for family water rides or even great stories for individual rides inside of water parks. With that being said, I think Skipper Canteen is going to go very, very deep in this tournament. So, Skipper.
Skipper Canteen, Eric.
Yeah, we early on, first round, we have a duel between two female sea members. And
I don't know if Alberta's a sea member.
I thought she was.
I think her father's a member. I don't think she's been inducted.
Someone could probably look that up. I thought Alberta was a sea member.
I don't think she is.
And in any case, it's a better story. Skipper Canteen.
Yeah. Nick?
Skipper Canteen is special because it transforms the way we even think about an existing legendary attraction.
An opening day attraction at Disney.
Exactly. So, I mean, that's really hard to do. And to give us something that special to go along with a ride that's special to many people and just enhance that experience is fantastic. It's wonderfully detailed.
Yeah. David?
Yeah, I agree. I really, really like Skipper Canteen and its backstory.
Marcy?
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with everybody. Skipper Canteen.
Spencer?
I've never been to Skipper Canteen, but now I kind of want to go.
There you go. I'm also picking Skipper Canteen. Everybody, Skipper Canteen, it's a blowout. All right, that's the end of the region. Let's put up the phone number if anyone's still awake. We're going to show you the phone number.
Happy Friday on the East.
8327-WDWNT7 is the phone number. Oh, boy. All right, we got to do other things. While that's happening, something else is going to happen here. Oh, it's time to find out the incorrect fact of the week. The incorrect fact of the week. Typhoon Lagoon was created when the Seven Seas Lagoon wave machine malfunctioned, sending a tidal wave across Walt Disney World.
There it goes. Still going.
And then put the Tilly right on. Yeah, right up there. There it is. Nick, take it away.
Let's do it.
Walt Disney presents
82. And I can't skip any because we got graphics for all of them.
Oh, boy. People need time to call anyway.
Yeah, they do.
Whoever's awake.
All right, we do have graphics, right? Okay.
We do have graphics,
all right?
Right?
So, all based on a tweet that went out, did we have the original picture? Yeah, we tweeted this picture.
Caption.
With asking you to caption this. So, here we go. Our first one. Made this little image right here. Look at that. Send check or money order to Tap Light in Paramount, California.
Yeah, Paston.
Haston, yeah.
Yeah.
Only 1995.
That's the greatest thing I've ever seen.
It's fantastic. Six of them. Oh, yeah. What a deal. Yeah. All right, Lexi gave us this one. If we blind the guests before they even enter, then they won't be able to see all the construction and barges with tears of joy.
Oh, boy.
Next one, Dreamfinder guy. Maybe this will get him to shut up about how bad the rest of the park looks. Mike Campbell wrote in, the electric umbrella has never been this bright or energy efficient.
I like that.
Paul wrote, clap on. Gladfall. Spaceship Earth. Andrew wrote, don't forget to change the batteries in your smoke detector when daylight saving starts. Very important to remember.
You know.
Xteen sees magic sparkles. Wrote it.
What? Tonga Xteen?
Oh, yeah, I guess it's Antonio. I'm reading the name. Sadly, bedazzling technology wasn't what they thought it would be in 2021.
Wow.
Very true.
Oh, wow.
Very true.
Oh, man.
At KJack 248, Alexa, order 11,324 as seen on TV pushlights. at okay. Ranger Wild wrote, how many Imagineers does it take to change a light bulb? With a little bit of a different twist.
In 2021, a lot.
Yeah, a little bit of a different twist on that joke. How many Phoenicians does it take to change a light bulb?
Gotta ask them.
Mike C. and Jay wrote, we'll never lose the golf ball in the rough again.
I get it.
Yeah. But Blue Sky Dizgay wrote in, do you think one of these stick-on closet lights will be bright enough?
Just I one. Like that
thinking
one.
Of, I don't
it
know.
Is just one.
Just one. Tiki Lagoon wrote, now my now ex-husband got me a closet light for my 50th, too.
Yeah, that's great.
Kicked him out pretty quick.
We set off someone's Alexa at home.
Nice.
You just ordered 11,000 lights at someone's house.
Just send Tom the bill.
Alexa,
go to Carousel.
Order 11,000 push lights
from the Carousel of Products. Let's see.
Oh, jeez.
Travis wrote, ah, yes, this should stop the water from leaking when it rains.
That was my favorite one. It's a plug.
Mm-hmm. Next one, Disco Spaceship Earth. Maybe. And Papa Deuce wrote in, stupid energy.
It could be Deuce.
It could be Deuce. I don't know.
Papa Deuce.
Papa Deuce.
Space Mountain, Papa Deuce a la Luna.
I thought they were going to do an ad campaign
Jimmy
for the Disney Value Resorts. It was just going to say, we'll leave a light on for you. We're taking that over.
All right. Do we have any... score changes?
Let me find out. It's refreshing.
Play the noise.
Nope,
maybe not.
Lots. I don't know, play the noise.
Play the noise.
Play the noise. I did not. I said nothing of the sort. I was about to say, not even one thing changed.
All right, it's folks, all last round, let's go.
Let's move it.
Let's
move
do
it.
This. Some of boat show.
Wait, we need an up. Auctioneer to run
it's
this one.
Some boat show. What's the first one? Kungaloosh! Whatever. Whatever it was. I can't even do it. It's too late to do the signal. Where is the... I don't know where the Adventurers Club went. I lost.
I think you should summarize all these in like two sentences each.
It was a club for adventurers.
I love it. Love it wins. It. Next.
I vote for it.
That's, yeah, I mean, I can't find it. That's it. Next. I don't know. Club for adventurers
we
versus.
Know.
It started, a couple people sold some fruit out of their truck, and it was very successful, and so it became a permanent farmer's market. Rosie was a lady who helped with the war effort at home.
Her name was Rosie. She sold some produce.
Yeah. The fun thing with this is the whole reason of the theme for Sunset Ranch Market and Rosie's and all that is to establish that you're not in the 1930s anymore. On Hollywood Boulevard, you're in the 1930s. Sunset, you're in the 1940s. We established that because Rosie's all about the war effort. The war was in the, you know, concluded in the 1940s. So it moves you forward in time as you go down Sunset Boulevard. Anyway, those are the stories. Let's go. Nick.
Kungaloosh.
Kungaloosh. Eric.
Everybody didn't love the Adventurers Club because the drinks were great. It's the story. It's the Adventurers Club.
Pete.
Adventurers Club, easy.
Yep, Adventurers Club. David.
Yep, same. Club.
Marcy.
Adventurers Club.
Kungaloosh. Spencer.
Well.
Kungaloosh.
Kungaloosh. All right, it's a blowout. Adventurers Club. Next. crush it. Remember when you could do that with other people? Crush it.
Me and you did that once.
We did ride together. Did we? No, Nick and I hit heads. That was the worst. Oh, my God. The Crush and Gusher is themed around a water ride built by the locals of Typhoon Lagoon from the remnants of a fruit exportation company's produce wash facility. The locale was owned by the Tropical Amity Fruit Exporters. Of course, you know Tropical Amity means friendship. Company which is based in Placid Palms, Florida, before the Great Hurricane. The hurricane devastated the Tropical Amity plant and destroyed one of its signs, making it say Tropic Calamity. Residents of Typhoon Lagoon renamed the plant to Crush and Gusher due to the Tropical Amity's Tropical Calamity's slogan. Our juices are crushed with flavor. Our produce is gushing with taste. The tubes, which were used for fruit transportation and produce washing, were repurposed as a slide at the resort. Yes. It's up against... Reg... No. Yeah. Oh, Dinosaur. I read the wrong thing. Dinosaur is... the Dino Institute was founded and opened as a site of as a fossil discovery park. An old fishing lodge of the property became Restaurantosaurus. Meanwhile, the Dino Institute and their partners at a research facility called Chronotech developed... how to warp vehicles through time, and thus started doing time rover tours back to the age of the dinosaurs. How? That's proprietary. Nick.
I mean, that's cool, but I mean, honestly, I'm going to go for Crush and Gusher. That story is just gorgeous. Yeah. How insane is that idea? Like, why would you come up with that idea? And for a water slide, let's do it. Crush and Gusher.
I'm with Nick.
Yeah.
I love Dinosaur, but
same.
The first time I went to Crush and Gusher, I was like, this is such a great idea. Yeah. And even the raft, I think, kind of has some, if I remember correctly, has some, like, box theme to it.
Yeah.
Like, you're riding on, like, boxes that were discarded. Like, you're just sledding on the boxes that were left behind.
They look like cardboard, and there's, like, no messaging.
Yeah. It's a really good story. Eric?
No.
No?
Dino.
Pete?
I thought I was going to be the only one you guys were going to make fun of me. Crush and Gusher.
Yeah.
For sure.
That's a good story.
To theme a water ride, and it just makes sense to, like, you can kind of see it. It's plausible. Yep. Oh, these are old pipes where, like, fruits just flew down these things.
How do you theme a off-the-shelf, like, water ride?
And it's amazing. And then even with, like, how the pipes are bent, and some of them look really convincing where you see, like, the bent and molded steel.
They've
and
got
like,
some, yeah.
Yeah, and you're like, oh, this is cool. Yeah. Like, it's run down. Yeah, the backstory for Crush and Gusher. Again, we're just doing backstories. I know everyone loves Dinosaur, but yeah, I guess
a better backstory. Marcy.
Yeah, they even have like crates of oranges and stuff. I love Crush and Gusher. I'm going to go
with
that. This is going to be an upset.
David!
Yeah, I got to give it for degree of difficulty, like you said, Tom, because how else were you going to do an off-the-shelf water ride? I mean, Dinosaur is a great attraction, but it is basically a museum with time travel, which is your first choice if you want to show dinosaurs.
Yeah.
So, Crush and Gusher. Gusher.
Spencer.
Crush and Gusher is just so creative. You guys are right. And it looks like a lot of fun, too. I'd go
Crush and Gusher. Next!
30 to 5.
That's a beating. Cosmic Rays Starlight Cafe.
Oh, boy.
Again, here we go again. I don't know where the backstory is. I don't know. Sunny Eclipse is here at the Starlight Lounge.
He's from New York. He came to your planet.
Hold on! Sunny Eclipse is here performing in the Starlight Lounge or the Starlight Cafe. He's in residence here. He plays regularly. He plays for Cosmic Ray here. Yeah, I don't know. They have a lounge singer at this restaurant in Tomorrowland. It's the whole story. I don't know. What's next? What's it up against? Rock and Roller Coaster. You're on a tour of G-Force Records, and then while you're on the tour, you happen to go into a recording studio where Aerosmith has popped in, and because they see you there, they're like, oh, hey, our fans are here. We can't just leave them here.
I want some backstage passes.
That's a great, I love that idea. And then they get you a super stretch limo and they take you to the show.
Come on, you know how we feel about our fans.
Wow!
Chris, could you grab my black Les Paul? Eric, what do you like?
Rock and Roller Coaster. G-Force Records has that connection to Tower of Terror, I think is really cool. I like that story.
There is, yeah.
Yeah, it's So, yeah, they are connected. There's a connected backstory between GeForce and a Tower of Terror.
What is it exactly? I can't remember now.
So, I don't want to get too deep into it. They're actually located next to each other, yeah, right? It's not. They're actually both on some, like, in Hollywood, yeah, right? And so their neighbors and some of the executives were at the Tower of Terror.
Like, they're at the party.
They were
right?
there at the party when the five people died. That's on right. the Tower of Terror when lightning struck. Yeah. The portal opened. Bad for business if you own a record company in that neighborhood. Yeah. So their business goes, you know, terrible for years and years and years. And then the record company starts signing, like, popular bands like Aerosmith in the 90s.
Yeah.
And so they become popular. And then there's demand for, like, hotel space. Yeah. So they reopen the Tower of Terror. And that is yeah. the... So I think that's a really cool backstory. I'm going to go with...
But now Eric likes long backstories.
What?
Pete!
What did you say? Yeah, I mean, I know a lot of people are going to be upset. But again, we're just doing backstories. We're not doing... cool spots. If this was best quick, you know, like worst quick service, or if this was best worst animatronic in a restaurant, or, you know, something like that, or best charm, it's super cool. Cosmic Rays is fun, but backstory wise, Rock and Roller Coaster does a good job conveying why you're there, why you're getting into a limo, that yeah. you have to be somewhere quickly, and it's got a great pre-show that ties it all together. And again, I think it makes your average Disney goer a little more knowledgeable as well as why you're doing what you're doing.
So. Nick.
Yeah, the Rock and Roller Coaster, tell a cohesive story of why I'm getting on this coaster is really done brilliantly.
I like Rock. I'm also picking Rock and Roller Coaster. David?
Yeah, same. With Cosmic Rays, outside of that one room, there is nothing to suggest that yeah. story. So, Rock and Roller Coaster.
Marcy?
Yeah, I love Sunny Eclipse, but the backstory for Rock and Roller Coaster is just so much fun. And honestly, it's probably one of the few that people actually know. I mean, like, it's very in your face. Like, when you get in there, there's no way that you can't, unless you skip the entire pre-show, there's no way that you can't, like, not know why you're there and what's the history of it. So,
Spencer,
I go with that.
Rock and Roller Coaster is very much in your face about their backstory. You're absolutely right, Marcy. Whereas Cosmic Rays is not. It kind of looks sad. I'll go with Rock and Roller Coaster.
He's from Unork on the planet Zork. Anyway. All right, Rock Roller Coaster wins. Next. Gideon's Bakehouse. It's a new one, but it has a nostalgia. It has a backstory that's not even fully fleshed out yet. They're going to reveal over time. According to Gideon's, during their construction process at the Lindworm Bookseller, a cult bookstore it used to be, they did some demolition and discovered a vintage ledger with an old, I don't even know what that word is. I don't know what that
spell
is.
It.
D-A-G-U-E-R-R-E-O-T-Y-P-E. Daguerreotype? I don't know what that is.
Daguerreotype.
Daguerreotype? What is that? It's a portrait? I don't even know. Of the shop's original owner in a small gap within a brick wall. Appears the name of the shop's original owner was Jonathan Lindworm, and Lindworm was a purveyor of rare books and antiquities. Gideon's indicated more of the story behind the mysterious character will unfold as the location continues to be open. What's it up against? Oh, goodbye. Goodbye, Gideon's. Tower of Terror to Tokyo Disney Sea. I'm going to give you the abridged version because you're going to be hearing this one a lot more through this tournament. This is the Hotel Hightower formed by C member Harrison Hightower III. Harrison Hightower was a mean, evil member of C. He liked to go to the different ports of call and essentially swindle or steal artifacts that he liked away from the people that it rightfully belonged to. Essentially, Lord Henry Mystic is the good guy version of this character, and Harrison Hightower is the bad guy. One of them collected things, like, if you ever go through the Q Mystic Manor, he's being clearly given things by people as, like, a thank you for helping or for his hospitality or whatever. Harrison Hightower in the murals in the lobby is very clearly stealing something from every port at Tokyo Disney Sea. In the end, Harrison Hightower, it all finally catches up with him because he's a rich guy and it has to catch up with him, right, Aaron? He finally
rich
steals...
Rich guys, the riches to corpse story?
He steals a cursed idol called Shiriki Utundu, and on New Year's Eve of whatever year it is, Shrieky decides to have some fun with him and sends him down an elevator shaft to his doom. And now you are back, thanks to the New York Preservation Society, touring the cursed Tower of Terror, the Hotel Hightower, many, many years later. That's why everyone's dressed as a tour guide. And they're, you know, they're obviously, the tour guides have no idea that this is really happening, that there's a real curse. They just think they're sending you on a fun elevator trip. They don't know any better. But there you go. All right, Gideon's or Tower of Terror? Eric?
Put me down for the rich guy story.
Rich guy. Pete?
I'm just want to say I'm proud of Gideon's for even coming up with a backstory.
Oh, it's great. They should be applauded for it. Yeah, absolutely.
So, plug to Gideon's. Nice work. And super cool inside.
But, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, you know where we're going.
We have $6 cookies as a consolation prize.
So,
Tower of Terror is one of the greatest backstories at any Disney park.
Yep.
There's no David. Question.
Yep. Tower.
Marcy.
Tower of Terror.
Nick.
I'm only Tower, but give me a second here because I got to do this justice. No, just give me a second. Number one. All right.
You're staying for the post show.
The Orlando location is beautiful. They have this tiny space inside the co-op. And it was great to see that they got a Disney Springs location where they can expand upon that theme and that concept because it's really, really cool. Here we go, real quick. This is the backstory to the thing. Give me a sec. In his never-ending search for baking inspiration, Steve Lewis, the bakery creator, purchased what he thought was an antique cookbook published in 1898. To his surprise, the margins were filled with faded notes. This isn't made up. With faded notes and doodles from what appeared to be a young boy who had dreams of becoming a baker. The name written at the back of the book was Gideon, and Steve decided to fulfill that child's wishes with the name Gideon's Bakehouse, paying tribute to the origins of the name. Gideon's shelves are lined with strange works of art, aging books, and curious antiques from the Victorian era.
Is that just a backstory for their other location?
Yeah, yeah. Yep.
It's a made-up story, right? It's not real.
I really don't know. I think he might have actually... No, I think that's how they got their name. I think he really found a cookbook from 1898 with different recipes.
That's really cool.
And then named the bake shop after the name he saw in the book.
That's very cool.
I believe that's
you know,
a real story.
We're all Gideon stands here
but
on
yeah,
show.
But yeah, Tower. Anyway, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, Tower. It's a blowout Tower. Next. The Indiana Jones Adventure Temple, the Forbidden... Oh, my God, these are long ones.
Summarize it, my lord.
Trying. An ancient Indian temple buried in a flood over 2,000 years ago has recently been discovered by Indiana Jones. It contains countless intriguing artifacts, but the real treasures are those offered by the temple deity Mara. The deity offers all who come to the hallowed site one of three gifts, earthly riches, eternal youth, or visions of the future. The only condition is that no one may look into the eyes of the idol. Although Jones's discovery, dubbed the Temple of the Forbidden Eye by the media, has set archaeological community abuzz, his funding eventually ran out, so he and Sala began conducting tours to raise money. Good fortune has come to the tourists who survived, but some have not returned. The families of the missing tourists beg Jones for help. Jones ventured inside the temple to find them approximately a week ago, but has not reappeared. Jones also hoped to find the temple's power source, the mysterious Jewel of Power, which Abner Ravenwood believes to be stored in an immense cavern guarded by the Gates of Doom. Marcus Brody has asked Sala to continue conducting the tours in hopes one of them will find Jones. Versus Camp Woodchuck. I love Camp Woodchuck. It's so cute. Camp Woodchuck is the cutest. Camp Woodchuck is where the Junior Woodchucks, an organization that itself is a send-up of the Boy Scouts, attend summer camp. It's, of course, from all the old Disney comic strips and comic books and such. As with other summer camps of this style, there are activity areas, trails, recreation, and, of course, a mess hall. So in the dining room, so they converted was an outdoor restaurant. It's just a service counter. And then built this big indoor space for you to eat in. So the mess hall is downstairs. If you go upstairs, there's suddenly arts and crafts on the wall. It's a shame this isn't an interior shot. There's arts and crafts on the wall. There's these like handmade paper masks of different characters like the Titter Twill Bird and all these other characters. It is, and then there's the exploration trails are essentially what lead to the meet and greets off to the side. It's a really, whenever you go to Tokyo Disneyland, this is a thing most people don't even talk about. It is one of the best themed, most beautiful areas I've ever seen. It's fantastic. It's going to get knocked out here, so I just want to sing the praises of Camp Woodchuck. I also want to mention that the people who make DuckTales are amazing because this building verbatim exists in an episode of the new DuckTales series, and it was the coolest thing I've ever seen. Like, everything about it was the same as this building. But anyway, So yeah, Camp Woodchuck versus Temple of the Forbidden Eye. Let's make it quick. Pete.
Indy.
Eric.
I.
Nick.
Go short for Indy. Sorry.
Or Forbidden Eye.
What? Temple! Spencer.
My heart breaks for Camp Woodchuck. I'm voting for it out of solidarity.
I don't blame you. That's fair. Marcy.
Indiana Jones.
Indiana Jones. David.
I'll complete the title, Forbidden.
There you go.
Hey, thank you.
Indy moves on. What's next? Adventure Isle at Shanghai Disneyland. Land is focused on the base camp of a group known as the League of Adventurers. If only there was some group they could have used in place of that. Located near the village of a friendly tribe of natives known as the Arbori. The League first arrived in the area in 1935 when an expedition was blown off course and landed in their jungle. With the scientists' peaceful intentions and fascination with the land's culture and environment becoming clear, the Arbori welcomed them and explorers have been arriving ever since. The main feature of the land is Roaring Mountain known as Aputaku in the local language. Expeditions into the mountain can be taken through Roaring Rapids by raft or by ropes course at Camp Discovery. It is up against, Kilimanjaro Safari's 1998 version.
Simba one.
Yeah.
Little Red.
If you look closely at advertisements, you'll notice they start to repeat, and if there are only so many businesses in this town. One of the most identifiable is Cap'n Bob, who sells tours. Cap'n Bob looks an awful lot like Joe Rohde, apparently. I don't even know if this is actually the story. This isn't the story. I don't know what this is. You're visiting a wildlife reserve, and of course this guy warns you there's going to be poachers, and eventually there's poachers, and then you end up in a chase, and then you, one of them's supposed to die, but kids were scared, so they had to change it, and so you hear over the radio that Big Red's fine, and you see Little Red in the back of the truck, and it's a very cute message about poachers.
And the vehicles are cool because they have luggage tied to them because you're going on a long trip. Them.
I don't know. Whatever. Nick picks them.
Kilimanjaro Safaris.
Safaris. I'm going with Adventure Isle. I like Adventure Isle. There's some cool stuff there. Pete.
Ugh, Tom. You are doing so well, Tom. No, this is awesome. I know we're not going to try. We're trying to save time here. But just put it in perspective. Like, you had real story on a ride that you didn't need a backstory for. Like, this is an amazing experience where you're seeing live animals where anything can happen and you're putting a backstory to that. I think that's amazing, and I also love that you didn't need to build, like, cool gigs, like the bridge doesn't work anymore, but, like, that tying into the story on, again, a safari, you don't need that kind of, like, those antics. It was awesome. Great, great story, safari.
Eric?
I'm not voting for some cheap knockoff Society of Explorers and Adventurers. I'm going with Kilimanjaro.
Marcy?
Yeah, safari.
David?
Yeah, I have problems with the execution of the safari backstory, but we'll get into that next time. I'm going to stick with that for now.
Spencer?
Sea or dust, you know? Let's go for Kilimanjaro.
Safari. All right, next matchup.
Safari's so good.
Avatar Flight of Passage. That's them programming it. Avatar Flight of Passage. The Alpha Centauri Expedition.
Yeah.
Oh, what are they? They're just watching. Oh no, it's actually the ride video. I thought they were just watching like fish videos. I like the crash dummy at the end with the arms out. I like that. The Alpha Centauri Expeditions, or ACE, has reactivated the Avatar program as a method of conducting research, but also of educating. Allows guests to sync with an avatar, to fly on a banshee, to partake in the Na'vi tribal coming of age tradition. Of course, this is in partnership with the Na'vi, again, to try to teach people about all this culture. Again, there's all sorts of backstory you learn in the queue, too, that we won't get into for the sake of time. And we will next time because it's up against the dumbest backstory, which is Kali River Rapids.
A 9 seed.
Anandapur Township is a different type of community than Harambe. Harambe is a town of concentration. Buildings are clustered together with a civic pride towards growth. Anandapur Township is more of a sparsely populated town with a hodgepodge of structures scattered around the landscape. The Imagineers try to give each land of Animal Kingdom a distinction of its own. For example, bamboo is a common sight in many parts of the real Africa, yet it was not planted in the recreation of the land. Obviously, it's used in Asia. There's a subtle detail, but important in the scheme of things, the evil king Bhima Disampati built a hunting lodge where he and his guests could stalk and kill tigers. Eventually, his regime was overthrown and a more eco-friendly attitude spread throughout much of the land. Today, the residents of Anandapur depend greatly on tourism for their livelihood. Throughout the township, a number of brightly painted signs entice visitors to see the various local attractions. Trekking through the forests and mountains, bicycling tours, and of course, whitewater rafting on the Shakaranadi River are all offered. In and around Anandapur Township, flyers like the one, you don't see it, it's not actually here. Flyers have been showing up. It seems that the Titok Logging Company is using slash and burn techniques and devastating the land. The local population is planning a protest meeting for Thursday evening to discuss, we missed it already, to discuss what can be done about this problem. Nick.
Another dead hunter.
I mean, honestly, I like the story of Cali River Rapids, but
it's
really
stupid.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of falls apart in places.
Oh, logging! Oh, we passively went past it. Oh, yeah. We're back. An elephant sprayed us.
I can't get past how much it just falls apart.
I disagree. I agree.
No,
with
go
you,
for
Nick.
It. What?
No, I agree with you. Just to I disagree with Tom. Where the ride is trash.
Yeah.
But the backstory is great.
Right.
They don't tell you any of the backstory.
I think so.
And it's more to me about conservation, protecting our planet. Then, like, and because I agree with you, it's like,
yeah, but
oh,
we already
we're
voted
on a family raft ride.
We voted
then
Maharaja
there's logs,
out.
Then there's some sound effects, a drop.
Yeah,
and
but
then
we voted
elephant.
Maharaja out because it's not apparent what the backstory is.
I agree
is.
That the theming and the backstory doesn't come across with the ride, and the ride is trash, but I think the story isn't bad. However, Flight of Passage backstory is farly superior. So, like,
yeah.
You gotta go Flight
So you're both picking Flight of
Passage.
Flight
of Passage, it's a better story.
Eric.
Sorry, I didn't mean to stop you there. Now.
Flight of Passage.
David.
Yeah, I actually disagree with Pete there because the story is you find the logging and then the next step is to go discuss it at a potential protest. So I'm not sure how what specific action you're taking there. Flight of Passage.
Marcy.
Because we
yeah, Cali is like the most disappointing ride at Animal Kingdom. So I'm going on Flight of Passage.
Spencer.
I've never been on Flight of Passage, but it can't be any worse than Kali River Rapids.
That's accurate. It's a blowout for Avatar. All right, last match. Oh, boy. Rockin' Space Mountain. This is my favorite backstory. You ready, everybody? The Red Hot Chili Peppers are throwing a concert on the space stage in space. To the tune of the band's cover of Stevie Wonder's Higher Ground.
Where is
That's
this?
That's the backstory! Oh,
wait, it's not where, even like an original this? Chili Pepper song.
Huh?
Where is this? I don't even know which
Disneyland. Was. This was at Disney.
Oh, no
this was
way. Disneyland? I didn't even know this.
There's an incredible backstory to the creation of this was, I'm just going to go for it. When they rebuilt Space Mountain from 2003 to 2005, it was built with two versions. You probably can't see it there. I think when it's lit, you can't see it. During the day, you could see it. Instead of the word space, there was clearly it could light up a different word. The word was rocket. So there were supposed to be two versions of the new Space Mountain, a daytime and a nighttime version. The nighttime version had like crazy lighting and different music and such. They never turned it on. So finally, by the time they got to the second year of the 50th, they were like, well, what's the promotion that we're going to do for spring? We got to do something to get people in the spring. Remember, this is when Disneyland was not doing well. Disneyland didn't turn around until 2005 with the 50th. So they still used to plan a lot of seasonal little things to get people to come in. So someone goes, look, if we're never going to do it, let's just do a two-park promotion. We'll find a band, and we'll do a quick overlay. So they did Rockin' Space Mountain and Rockin' California Screamin'. Both of them to Red Hot Chili Peppers. It's the only time all of that stuff that was put in for Rockin' Mountain ever got used.
Cool.
That's the whole story. There you go. It's much cooler than the actual backstory.
Look forward to this losing in a moment.
Yeah, it's going.
For whatever it's up against.
It's a 16 seed for a reason. What's it up against? It is up against the greatest backstory in history. Our all-time favorite. That's right. If I can find it. If not, I'll probably just tell it myself. Yeah, no, I'm biased, but it's the best.
Just a bit.
In addition to the attraction's regular story of Splash Mountain, a backstory explains how Chickabin Hill came to be flooded. A moonshiner named Rackety Raccoon built an explosive blueberry moonshine still near the dam of the Beaver Brothers.
You have my attention.
When a malfunction caused Rackety's blueberry still to explode, it caused the dam to burst and flooded most of the area around Chickabin Hill. To this day, it is why water runs off of the mountain. Obviously, the land in Tokyo specifically does more with these characters. This Rackety Raccoon story actually carries through all the versions of the ride. That's why you see, it may be a different character, but there's a muskrat moonshine up at the top of our Splash Mountain. But yeah, Rackety actually has a saloon here. And then the Beaver Brothers have an attraction. They have the canoes, which the story is they hollowed out the canoes. There's more to this. We'll get into it next time, I'm sure. But yeah, Pete.
Critter Country.
Thank you, Eric.
Drunken hillbilly raccoon. Yeah, I'm in. It's Critter Country.
We miss you.
All
Raccoon.
I heard was saloon and still.
Right in from the law.
Moonshine.
Although when you said they changed one letter, I thought you were going to say it was like Spice Mountain during the day. And Space Mountain.
Spice Mountain.
Spice Girls Mountain.
Spice up your life.
Splash, moonshine, go.
What are Spice Girls? I'm also picking Rackety Raccoon. Marcy?
Yeah, if you're going to do a concert in space, you have to at least tie it into something Disney and use Protozoa. But yeah, I'm for sure going
it has to be an IP concert, of course.
It could have been a Goofy movie.
David?
Always Rackety. Always go with Rackety.
Spencer?
Exploding blueberry moonshine.
You're damn
like
right.
Rackety. Dream.
You're damn right. All right. There's, give him the phone number.
There's no way. Everything's 3035.
Yeah, we have to give him the phone
number. Yeah, no, I know.
There's the phone number. We're going to take a commercial break while you guys call in. We'll be right back.
No one's even up to call.
No one's awake. It's fine.
We're still praying for the people.
We'll begin with the capability test to see how your vehicle designs perform under challenging weather and service conditions.
From Disneyland Resort President Ken Potrock, it's time for the candy every Legacy Passholder will crave.
Potrocks!
Potrocks are colorful, flavorful fun that you'll be hooked on once you get just a touch of it. Just rip open a bag and let the fun begin. Sometimes you get candy, and sometimes, well...
All I got was 30% off my next Potrocks purchase.
What a deal! Makes you forget that you didn't even get any of the candy you paid for.
Not really.
Potrocks come in 4 financially conservative flavors. Angry former pass holder, canceled pass, park still closed, and ruby grapefruit. Watch out for the angry pass holder bag. It's really bitter. Potrocks, they'll leave a bad taste in your mouth. And no, it's not a drug thing.
I have lower profits and I need cash now.
Call Gavin Newsom. Open the theme parks now. Open the theme parks now.
My salary is restored, but I need cash now.
Call Gavin Newsom. Open the theme parks now!
I fired thousands, I'll can you too. All our layoffs, I will blame on you. Only care about me, and I need cash now.
Call Gavin Newsom! Open the theme parks now!
Open the theme parks now!
Now.
Right now!
Introducing WDWNT Entertainment, the new home for your favorite WDWNT shows, including Geekly Kingdom, a nerdy talk show with discussions, games, and interactive trivia. Deep in the Plus, diving into and reviewing the catalog available on Disney Plus. Cosmic Read Live, a show talking music, merchandise, vacation memories, and imagineering attractions. WDWNT The RPG, a tabletop-style role-playing game like D&D but set in the parks. Ride Rehab, a satirical show of fixing attractions or ruining them even more. And many new and exciting programs to come. Subscribe now at youtube.com/WDWNTEntertainment.
Welcome back to WDW News Tonight. Let's find out what's happening this week on Nintendo Switch. Roger Rabbit's Splatoon Spin this week on Nintendo Switch. Make sure you pick that. Make sure you pick that up. Roger, we've been splatted. All right, anything happen?
Hit that music.
Oh no!
Oh no!
Oh no!
Don't do it to me.
Alright. Looks like Cosmic Rays. 17 calls, but not enough.
No, just kidding. They got like 5. They still, yeah.
No, nothing was close enough. Even they had to have like double digit calls. We didn't, for any particular attraction, we didn't get that. Nothing was overturned. We're good.
So the only thing that was overturned tonight was the space gun.
Yep.
Space cannon.
Space cannon.
Was it?
All right, if you're a Wings member and you have insomnia, there's a post-show coming on
after
this.
Watching Hawaii.
And remember, kids, it appears everyone is doomed at Phantom Manor, even you.